Clover was a lovely dog. Knowing my smoking was to blame was like somebody had just put a bullet into my heart. It was a nightmare that had come true. What are you laughing at?
If there's a bustle in your hedgerow, don't be alarmed now. It's just the two mics flicking through tomorrow's papers.
What are you doing in my shrubbery, you dirty little...
Nocturnal stirrings from the night garden of sporting news with Mike Ninkynonk Graham and Mike Pinky Ponk Parry on Talk Sport. If you're up with a baby, you'll get it.
Look at the light!
I am a unit.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two Mikes, and I'm delighted to say that it's time to say a very, very good morning to a much cooler looking Mr. Mike Porky Parry. Very good morning to you.
Yeah, good morning, Mike. Cooler on a number of planes or a number of levels. Levels, yes. That's what I meant. Yeah. First of all, of course, Everton got through tonight, and they didn't scrape through,
well,
by the way.
Scrape through.
No, they didn't scrape through. Well, they played a Premier League team, right?
Yeah.
And it's 1-1 at 90 minutes, and and then it was 1-1 after an extra 30 minutes of extra time, and then they kept their cool and scored all
and
four penalties.
And they won 4-3 on penalties.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I say they scraped through.
That's not scraping through. You don't know what the word scraping
means. I tell you
what,
it's fortunate that they don't have replays anymore in the old League Cup, isn't it? Because otherwise you'd have had to go to Norwich, where nobody goes.
It'd be a complete waste of time. Well, now, I can't remember, but you'll have to jog my memory for me. Yeah. Are the semi-finals two-legged?
I don't think so.
Mike.
I can't remember either.
Do you know, it's a real blank.
Well, don't worry, you won't have to worry about that, because Everton aren't going to get to the semi-finals.
Well, the next round is the quarter-final, so I'm hoping... You see, what was great about tonight's result wasn't just that Everton got through, but the League Cup has a habit of throwing up shock results, which helps you if your most dangerous opponents go out. Chelsea and Arsenal both got out tonight. That is brilliant. I'm sorry for Chelsea and Arsenal fans.
Have you seen who's still left in?
Hey?
Have you seen who's still left in?
Well, Hull. Yeah. And on paper, we should be a better team than them.
Yeah.
Stoke, who are a very good team.
Yeah. Okay.
And then, of course, there's four games tonight.
There is.
Which includes Liverpool.
Yes. Manchester United.
Yes.
And Manchester City.
Oh.
And Crystal Palace.
Ah.
So you'd have to say there's still some quite good teams left in, with the greatest of respect to Everton.
Yes, there are. But, of course, the draw will be tomorrow night.
Yes,
now, if we get a favourable draw, for instance...
Tonight, indeed. Yeah.
If we get a favourable draw, so at home against a team that's not in the top four in the Premier League, I would be very happy indeed. Thank you very much indeed.
But that would be the last eight, wouldn't it?
Quarterfinals.
Yeah, so
and then you're in the semis. And that's why I'm asking you. I can't remember. I don't know why. I've got this mental block.
Yeah.
I mean, somebody will tell us.
Somebody
from behind the glass
will
tell us. Are the semi-finals played on a one-off basis? They can't be on a one-off basis. Because if they're on a one-off basis...
I don't think they've got enough time in the schedule to put two legs
But
in
it can't be... If it's one-off, it'd have to be a neutral ground. It's not at a neutral ground, is it? So it must be two legs. It must be.
Well, I don't know. Maybe they're just drawn that way.
Do you know what it indicates? It indicates how poorly we've done, we being Everton, have done in this competition over the years. First time in 8 years we've got to the quarterfinals.
Yeah.
So we haven't been anywhere near the semi, so I've probably not taken any notice of those who were there. But it's the one trophy Everton need to win. Because
any trophy, really.
Every other competition we've ever entered, bar the European Cup / Champions League, we've at some stage won.
Yeah.
And,
you've never won the League Cup?
Never won the League Cup.
Ah.
Been a League Cup final. Yeah. I went when I was about, how old would I have been? About 20.
Yeah.
We played West Ham at Wembley.
Yeah.
1-1. Mm. Now, Alvin will be listening on his way home here.
Yeah.
And then the replay, which I
think... Would he have been playing in it? No.
No, he wouldn't have been playing in it, no. And the replay at Old Trafford, I think it was, we lost 2-1.
Yeah.
No, hang on, wait a minute. Is that West Ham?
Surely
Aston
they would have
Villa?
Played the replay.
That might have been Aston
Surely
Villa.
They would have played it at Villa Park, wouldn't they? Because it'd be in the middle of the country.
Yeah, well, it wouldn't if there was Aston Villa, would they?
Hey?
It might have been Aston Villa. No, it was West Ham. In fact, we played. No, we played in two
I'm
finals.
I'm so confused.
No, we played in two finals.
What are you
one against
about?
West Ham, one against Aston Villa,
right.
But they were both in the 70s.
Were they both at Old Trafford?
No, one replay was at Old Trafford.
Oh,
we lost the other one.
God. I'm so confused.
Yeah, I'm confused now as well. I'm going to look up my records
because
it's
a
long time ago.
Maybe we should start that one again.
Yeah, okay. Maybe
we
will.
Should we do the result of winners and losers instead?
Yes, I'm very much looking forward to this.
Yeah, because, of course, what we did was we changed the format slightly.
Yeah.
And we said that you should go second rather than first because you thought that your nominations would then be retained in the memories of the people listening.
Yes.
And those listening on podcasts as well later on.
Yes.
And here's how it worked out.
Great.
It was retweeting for Mike Parry this week.
Yes.
And favouriting for me.
Yes.
The result is as follows. Retweets 203.
Woo, woo, woo.
Favourites, 369.
Oh, don't be ridiculous. You've gerrymandered that.
I haven't.
I was leading up till about midday today.
You were never leading. No,
I was.
No, you were never leading.
That's an absolute outrage.
That's a massive defeat.
I kept getting...
Do you know it's now 7-3?
I kept getting messages all day saying, you know, Porky, you're way ahead.
No, Well, you were getting them from your demented followers. I got don't messages. Know what they're talking about.
I got one message today which said, you know, vote for Porky in the winners and losers.
Yeah.
And 56 similar people. Messaging you on this same thing. So right now from now on, from next week.
So what do you want to do now? So you've tried going second, right?
No.
You've tried only being favourited instead of being retweeted.
I mean, the quality.
You've tried about five different versions of
the quality of my winners and losers was outstanding. Everybody loved Marouan Fellaini being a loser. Everybody loved it.
No.
And let me tell you this, next week we're doing a straight. What's it called?
I don't know. What do you call it?
We're going to do a straight vote next week. It's not going to be.
So we do every week.
No, you don't. Next week, it's going to be a vote on the what do you call it? On the web or the internet or something.
A vote on the internet.
Well, vote on the internet.
Where are you going to set this vote up?
Well,
I'll let you do it then.
No, I'm going to.
You can set the vote up, and then you can then claim that you know exactly that
it's
nobody's
not
interfered
my
with it.
Job to
no,
put
but
together.
I think it's only fair.
The technical mechanics of this show, but somebody who's knows how to do these things will put together.
Well,
where somebody puts a tick in the Porky box or a tick in the MG box.
Well, that's what they do now.
No, they don't.
They retweet their favourite.
They get confused. They get very, very confused.
Well, maybe your lot do.
No, don't. They get confused because you change the goalposts every blinking week.
I mean, all the people that vote for me will sometimes vote for you as well. All the people that vote for you will only vote for you.
Yeah.
I mean, if anybody gerrymanders the thing, it's you. But the problem is you're not very good at it,
it's
so
not.
You always lose.
No.
7-3, a massive chasm.
No, we're going to have... No, I don't take any store by those figures that you keep pumping in the air.
What do you mean?
We are going to rearrange it next week so that...
Well, I'm not going to rearrange it.
We're going to put a page up, right?
I'm not going to do it.
And then on this page, you either tick Porky or you tick MG.
Well,
somebody will sort
page,
that out.
Where is this page going to exist?
Well, it'll exist somewhere. I'll find out.
Right.
And we'll sort it out,
okay?
Because I am fed up with your absolute damned outrageous cheating. You
I'm
know.
Not cheating.
You know
I
that
don't
you.
Do anything.
While I'm busy doing things, you know, while I'm busy building, you know, the empire and all this kind of
what
stuff.
Empire?
You know, the empire.
Your
that,
empire.
Whatever.
I'm busy building your empire.
Whatever. You just go around sniffling.
No,
and...
I don't.
And,
I've spent
and,
most of the day sleep today.
And grovelling. Yeah. Well, that says it all.
So if
that
I must be an incredibly talented gerrymanderer.
That says it
I
all.
If I can do it in my sleep.
That's what you always do. You dozy head.
No, I didn't sleep yesterday.
That's all you are.
You might have heard I had some car trouble.
Oh, by the way,
I got an update for you on that.
Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah, but I've got a fantastic story about travel today.
About the trains.
Yeah.
I saw your tweet, yeah.
I had to get into London this morning to go and see some video producers, right?
Oh, yeah.
Involved with something you and I are doing at the moment, which we'll tell the audience about later. You couldn't believe it. On the train on the way home, the driver suddenly stopped halfway between Victoria Station and Clapham Junction.
Yeah.
And he actually said, you know, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry. And this was a great new train, you know, there was nobody on it, so it was great for me. I didn't want all these, you know, terrible people
surrounding me. You're like the Sam Fox of South West Rail.
Well, something like that. And and actually said, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very sorry to have to tell you, when this train gets to Clapham Junction, it is going no further. I will have to ask you to get off. I don't know why I'm going to have to get off.
Yeah.
If anybody on this train has a clue what's going on, please let me know, because I don't.
He was the driver?
Yeah, thoroughly fed up.
Yeah, and it turns out he'd taken the wrong train or something, right?
He hadn't taken the wrong train. They'd given him the wrong train.
Yeah.
When we got to Clapham Junction, you know, I went storming up to see the driver, and I was going to be very civil, because I thought, well, it's perhaps not his fault.
Right.
And he actually said, I'm really sorry. He said, but they sent me to the wrong train. This train shouldn't be going to Horsham. It should be going somewhere else. I said, just change it round. He said, no, I've got to take it back.
Surely there must be some mechanism to stop somebody taking the wrong train. That sounds like a health and safety issue.
Do you know what? A few minutes later, he had to go down the other end of the train, get in, and, you know, because, like, trains are like worms.
Yeah.
You can have a head at either end,
that's true.
So to speak. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, mind you, if you cut them in the middle, they'd still survive as well.
Yeah, exactly. That's right.
You'd have two trains.
Yeah, exactly. You would. Yeah. Very, very like worms trains, you know, when you think about it like that. So, what are you laughing at? So
the 836 worm.
Yeah, that's
from,
right.
Waterloo to Corsham.
So he goes back down the other end and starts. And so I said to the guy, I said, what about us? What about me? What about these passengers?
I'm sure that's what you said. What about me?
Yes, liberty and freedom. Yeah. And can I get a refund on my free ticket? That would have been good, wouldn't it? Yeah. I love it. Yeah.
Well, we'll hear the end of that story in a moment. Exactly. I'll give you an update. A couple of people.
Just watching the highlights here of Everton Norwich.
Yeah, it's not going to be long.
On our internal monitoring machines.
Fernley and Mark have said it's two legs, the semi final of the Capital World Cup. So there you go.
On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
The pressure's on now.
Relieve the itch. Talk Sport.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. It's Ask Porky coming up a little bit later on. We have given you the result of winners and losers, but I'll be tweeting it out, of course.
Yeah, I don't believe it, by the way. The two and mics, don't believe it, folks. Don't believe mics. It.
The result is as follows.
Send in the protest,
I've
please.
I've won by 369 votes to 203.
Outrageous.
So it's a massive
rubbish.
Victory.
Ridiculous.
And 7-3 is a very, very large chasm. That's
now I don't know what
up.
Your 7-3 is all about. You go on week in, week out, you go on about it. Please send in your protest tweets, emails, anything you want. Old MG has gerrymandered in a most massive way. Massive, I mean, mega gerrymandering.
Here's one from Max, who's tweeted in at the two mics. Don't hear the sound of the cooler. Is the dodgy aircon at TalkSport sorted out, or has Porky turned cold?
No, it's actually beautifully cold in here tonight.
There's
isn't
a bucket
it?
Arrangement around the corner.
It's
what
unbelievable.
For.
Well, funny enough.
I mean, it's not exactly high tech around here, is it?
Funny enough, the bucket arrangement around the corner, where there's a pipe sticking out of a wall into a bucket, has got a notice on it saying, you know, to whom it may concern. Empty this bucket at regular intervals as it will fill up on a half-hourly basis due to condensation coming out of the air conditioning.
The air conditioning system seems
except
to be working.
There is no condensation in the bucket. And it hasn't been ever since I got it two hours ago.
Oh, OK. So there's nothing going in there?
There's nothing going in there.
Well, it's a mystery then, because why is it so cool?
I don't know. As long as it stays this way, that's all right.
Now, here's one from Martin. He said, Aston Villa lost 2-1, replay West Ham FA Cup lost 2-1. Devonshire. Can you make sense of that?
Alan Devonshire.
Can you make any sense of that?
Yeah,
tweet?
I can. So we played in two finals and lost them both in replays.
All right, okay.
That's what it looks like. Martin might have played in one of them, actually.
Okay. Roy says, look at the bottom line is, when old MG put you, Porky, as number one loser, it resonated with the listeners as you are a pain. So they all voted for me.
I take objection to that. I take exception, it is.
And Freddie has one that's in favour of you. Porky should have won winners and losers by default, as old MG messed up the order.
Yeah.
One thing that Mike Parry never gets wrong.
Exactly. Absolutely right. Listen, by the way, I want to tell you something which I learned today before I forget.
Yeah, go on.
Now, I've told you about Albert Einstein, haven't I?
What about him?
Well, I've told you that, you know, his theory of relativity and all that, and I believe that Wayne Rooney's brain works more efficiently than Einstein's because he has to work on a more complicated equation on how
Well, he's not doing too well at the moment, is he?
Well, he's not actually, no. But how
you
to turn
part of his brain is shut down.
How to turn a ball through the air and hit it in the right direction and avoiding.
But so what's happened to his ability to do that?
Well, I don't know, but it's not about Wayne Rooney. This, even though there is a chapter in my book, Rooney Tunes, about the whole thing.
Which book?
Rooney Tunes.
Oh, yeah.
Rooney
Is that
Tunes.
Still available?
Still available, yeah. But anyway, listen, how about this? Because we'll get back on the football in a sec, because I want to talk to you about the fact that I feel very sorry for Theo Walcott suffering an injury after 13 minutes.
Well, that's got to do with football, hasn't it?
Eh?
That's got to do with football.
Yeah, we'll get back to that in a minute. Albert Einstein was once addressing the Oxford Union.
Oh, yeah.
And he was born in 1879, died in 1955, right? But he came up with the theory of relativity when he was about 30 years of age.
Yeah.
So that would have been in about, like, 1910, 1911, something like that, you know?
Yeah.
And he was addressing the Oxford Union, and an undergraduate said, "You're only here for 3 hours, Mr. Einstein.
Yeah.
Does that give you time to explain to us your theory of relativity?"
Mm.
Which, of course, led to the formation of the nuclear bomb. You know that, don't you?
Yes.
Right. So he said,
it was
yes.
The splitting of the atom, wasn't it?
Splitting the atom, yeah. So this is so brilliant. I can't believe it. And I've got to tell you this, because I came across it today.
Yeah.
So Mr. Einstein, who had a sort of stilted sort of German accent and spoke like this.
Well, was he from Germany?
Yes, he was.
That would probably explain it, then.
Yes, he was originally. He said, "No, it will take me 10 seconds. He said, the undergraduate said, "Really?" He said, "Yes." He said, "When a man sits with a pretty girl for an hour, it seems like a minute. But let that man sit on a hot stove for a minute, and it feels longer than an hour. This is relativity."
Yeah, very good.
That's brilliant.
It is brilliant.
Isn't that brilliant?
And it's very easy to understand.
Exactly.
Mm.
Doesn't that explain everything?
It doesn't really.
It does.
Because there's a lot of supplementary questions you'd ask.
No,
wouldn't you?
Well, nobody asked any supplementary questions after that.
They're not as clever at Oxford as they think they are.
Yeah, well, I mean, didn't you? That was brilliant.
How does that explain everything?
Well, what it means is...
Some things feel different to others.
No, but we've already established, haven't we, talking to the prof from America last week, that time travel now is possible. We've worked it out. And the way we've worked it out is that all we've got to do is wait for NASA to build a spaceship that goes faster than the speed of light, right?
Yeah.
And you can
that's time travel, isn't it? We talked about that the other week.
I've just said this to you.
No, but it's not relativity, though.
No, it is relativity. It's all the same. Mm. It's all the same, because what I'm saying is that if you took off in your rocket at the speed of light, went and whizzed around Mars and came back, you'd come back before you started. Uh-huh. And that's time travel.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
So what relativity in this sense is from Albert Einstein is the fact that, for instance, if you were having your teeth pulled out slowly for a period of 20 minutes, no, it's true, that 20 minutes would seem like 3 or 4 hours because it'd be very painful, particularly if they'd set fire to your feet at the same time.
You came out with one last night, which a lot of people remarked upon,
where
you described how your heart was deteriorating at an increasingly rapid rate.
That's right, as I get older.
Yeah. No, deteriorating slowly at an increasingly rapid rate.
Yes, that's right, yes. Right. Yes, it is, yeah.
So how was it deteriorating slowly at a rapid rate? That was a question a lot of people were asking me.
Well, what I mean is it continues to deteriorate.
Right.
Slowly,
right?
But the slowliness is getting faster. If you see what I mean.
So the slowliness, after a while, it won't be slow anymore because it's ever increasing.
Well, it's proportional. Mm. But I mean, that's a different one. You've got me off the track. So what I'm saying is, so if you're having your teeth pulled out at the same time as somebody setting fire to your feet with a lighter or something like that, that the period of time is very, very long in your mind.
Yeah.
However, if as Albert Einstein says, you're sitting next to a pretty girl, maybe you get even more intimate with the pretty girl, then you'd want that to go on all day, but it would seem like only an hour. Mm. So that is brain relativity. Do you see what I mean?
Well,
and that puts you that puts you into a time zone, a time zone of your own making.
So what you're saying
that's what he's saying.
So what you're saying is time can pass either quickly or more slowly, depending on what you're doing.
Exactly. That's
so
exactly
that makes
right.
a lot more sense. Now, do you know that LL Cool J also said something similar in a film, The Deep Blues Sea?
No.
He says, put your hand on a hot stove, a minute feels like an hour. Put it on a hot woman, and an hour feels like a minute.
Who said that?
LL Cool J.
And who's LL Cool J?
LL Cool J is a rapper and he's an actor.
And what year was that?
I don't know. The Deep Blue Sea was the film.
Okay.
Well, it was probably after Albert Einstein said
it. I was about to say, Albert Einstein said this in about 1912.
Yeah.
So old Cool J is just
Old Cool J.
Yeah, he's just an imposter.
Yeah.
You know? There's lots of imposters around in the world, Mike. You'll find a lot of people
trying
to impersonate things we do.
Now, here's a guy who may or may not be an imposter called Marcus.
Oh, yes.
Who's texted in, claiming to have cut your hair today.
What?
Did you have your hair cut today?
No, I did not.
Let's have a look at it. You did have it cut today.
I did not have it.
It looks different from yesterday.
Mike, I've just come out of the shower. That's why it looks different, right?
Really?
As I do every night.
It looks like the way you had it the night.
What does this guy say?
He says, I cut Porky's hair today. He said, make me look like John Lennon circa 1972. He only talks about himself.
No.
It must be the same guy.
No, it's not. I haven't had my hair cut today. I haven't had my hair cut before our last show. When was that?
That was September the 25th.
When we did the Head and Chickens, yes. That's
right. Well, I think you've had it done again.
I have not had it done.
So is this guy Marcus an imposter then?
He's trying to wind you up. Don't worry about that.
All right.
Listen, getting back to the football, right?
Yeah.
Misery for Arsenal and Chelsea tonight. Yes. Great joy for Everton. And isn't it significant that the goal was scored by Leon Osman?
Why?
He's been at Everton like 16 years.
Oh, yeah.
So to be the saviour tonight was absolutely terrific. We go into the next. I can't wait for that draw tonight. Wonder who we'll get. Somebody, you know, who's not quite as good as us.
Could be Manchester City.
I don't fear Manchester United.
Could be Liverpool.
Don't fear Manchester City, really. Don't fear anybody yet to the stage of the competition.
John has tweeted in from Amazon to say that Rooney Tunes is still available.
Rooney Tunes?
Yeah, Rooney Tunes. No, it's still available on Amazon. Doesn't say what price it is.
Do you say he's tweeted from Amazon?
No, he's tweeted a picture of Amazon store.
I think it's gone into reprint, actually. It was a very popular book.
Yeah.
So anybody who wants to get it can get it on Amazon.
You get 100 copies for £1, can't you?
That's your favourite joke, isn't it?
Mm. Eh? Stephen says he voted for me because Mike Parry was knocking ex-Everton players and doing Fellaini over again. So that's why you didn't get the vote.
Hang on. Fellaini was cited in two very specific stories, neither of which brought him out in much of a light. The fact that he's a former Everton player...
Yeah, but you wouldn't have put him in as a loser if he was playing for Everton, would you? I think we all know the answer to that.
I'm not sure about that one. I can't answer that one. The thing is, he wasn't playing for Everton. By the way, isn't Halloween creeping up on us?
Well, not really.
You're going to be out with your children on that night?
Well, yeah, probably.
Trick and treating?
Yeah, well, we don't do too much of that, but we do a little bit of it.
You've got to be very, very careful. I'm very serious about it. Very careful about the clothes that children wear.
Yeah, I know.
Because you remember the Claudia Wilton situation.
Yes, I do.
Horrific. And I've seen some tests in the papers over the weekend saying they're not sure that they are all fireproof,
well,
these clothes.
I've got some Halloween stories for you, actually.
Excellent,
tell you.
Good.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. Coming up next, we're going to talk about Jose Mourinho and Chelsea.
Yeah.
Rugby World Cup 2015 on Talk Sport with MasterCard. To celebrate the biggest event in the rugby universe, MasterCard is turning the world over. Prices. Get essential updates from every match throughout the tournament. Plus, passionate comment and expert analysis from a team of iconic internationals, including Brian Moore and David Campese. It's the greatest show on home turf. Rugby World Cup 2015 on TalkSport with MasterCard. Worldwide partner of Rugby World Cup 2015.
Because road conditions change in a second, BMW's intelligent four-wheel drive switches power from rear to front wheels in just 1/10 of a second.
From rear
to front. From front
to rear.
From rear to front. Delivering grip that's almost magnetic. xDrive. Available on models across the range, including sports hatch, saloon, coupe and touring. To find out more, visit your local BMW centre.
Vice called Halo 5 Guardians spectacular. Eurogamer named it the best sci-fi first-person shooter campaign in the business. And official Xbox magazine called it one incredible game. Join the greatest hunt in gaming history. Buy Halo 5 Guardians at Tesco now for only £35 when you buy selected Xbox Live cards and subs. Tesco, every helps. PEGI 16, terms and conditions apply.
There's a person who can spot threats in the sky before they become threats. They can reassemble a pistol in 15 seconds and maintain equipment so advanced most don't even know it exists. That person's you. There are more than 50 roles to choose from in the RAF. You'll receive world-class training to develop new and existing skills. And you can do it full-time as a regular or in your spare time as a reserve. Find your role in the RAF. Search RAF Recruitment now.
Left a bit. Right a bit. Little bit more to the right.
The fusspots. We like you. Because you're not happy until everything is just right. And at Wix, nor are we. That's why we have a stylish range of tiling and flooring to suit all tastes. And right now, there's up to half price off all styles, so you can get everything 100% right. Wix. Let's do it right.
This is the unique go-kart feeling of a turbocharged Mini Cooper three-door hatch. And this is how it feels, knowing that you got it. For just £189 a month, plus initial rental. Book a test drive at your nearest Mini Centre or mini.co.uk/turbo. 48-month hire agreement from Mini Financial Services, £2,399 initial rental. Subject to status, guarantees may be required. Available for new vehicles ordered by 31st of December and registered by 31st of March. Participating retailers only. Mileage and other conditions apply when you return the vehicle. Visit mini.co.uk/turbo.
When you need all the latest form and odds on all the day's sporting action, and you need it fast, you need the Coral Daily Download. Get all the latest news and great offers on all the big games and all the biggest race meetings in one essential package, delivered to your ears at the speed of sound. Don't miss the Coral Daily Download every morning on the Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast from 6 on Talk Sport with Coral. Your best bet for breakfast.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. It's Ask Porky tonight, of course. And don't forget, we did discover last night what the quiz subject is going to be this week, and it's Isambard Kingdom Brunel.
That's it. Yeah.
A man who, as you've described, is a Great Britain, is a true hero of yours and someone you know an awful lot about.
Yes, I know an awful lot about him. I sometimes eat in a restaurant named after him, actually,
do
down
you?
On the coast. Yes, yes.
Why is there a restaurant named after him?
Well, because he's. It's
he wasn't renowned for his sort of culinary expertise, was he?
No, no, but it's Portsmouth, isn't it? Where a lot of ships were built, including ships that he designed.
Oh, right.
And
the first iron ship. ship, I think, was made there.
Well, he built the biggest ship in the world, called the Great Eastern.
Yeah, that was, wasn't that the first iron ship?
No, I don't think it was the first iron ship, but it was certainly the biggest in the world.
Really?
And actually, it was a little bit inefficient because it was fueled by like coal, steam, and all that kind of stuff. And you had to put so much coal on the ship, you know what I mean?
Right.
To
get it a bit heavy.
Get it across the Atlantic. Yeah, yeah, basically, that was it. Yeah.
Now, I don't know who Gav is from Glasgow. You have any idea who Gav from
Gav
Glasgow
from
is?
Glasgow?
Yeah.
No?
Well, I don't know where he's coming from on this, but you may remember this. He says, after the disgusting attacks on Mr. Parry's illness last week by that Judas MG,
I extend
my appreciation to him for working through the pain for us all.
Yeah.
I also demand an apology from Mr. Parry, who is clearly too polite to get one himself.
So Gav is demanding an apology on my behalf.
Yeah, is he messaging?
Are you prepared to offer this apology?
I have nothing to apologise for.
You have actually questioned whether or not I've got a dodgy
heart.
That's
true. Yeah, I have.
Right, now, here, I'm going to tell you something now, which is going to shame you to your boots, right?
I've never felt shame in my life.
I had to sort out a load of papers last week because I went to see my one of my financial advisors on Monday morning.
One of your financial advisors?
Yes, one of them, yeah.
Is this to handle one of your six bank accounts?
It was, actually,
none of which is black.
None of them are red, hopefully, although I don't check them. Anyway, the point of the story is...
What is the point of the story?
I go through all these papers. I suddenly find the file marked Harefield Hospital.
Mm.
And within that file, I find a letter from Dr. Nicholas Banner, who's
Dr.
one of
Banner.
The world's top...
Good old
Dr.
Banner. Don't make him angry.
Indicating that transplant surgery will probably be the best course
Well, let's have a look at it then.
What do you mean?
Well, let's have a look at the letter.
I can't make that letter public.
Why not?
It's a confidential letter between doctor
and
patient.
Well, it's confidential to you.
Yes.
Well, you can make it public if you want to.
You could give yourself
permission to release it in order that people will understand that you really are ill.
I would need...
And not just pretending.
I would need permission from Dr. Banner.
No, I'll get that.
And,
I'll ring him up.
No, you won't.
I want to get Dr. Banner on the show.
It's not that he wouldn't come on the show. He doesn't seek publicity.
I don't think he exists.
He's only one of the top men in the country. You can look him up in any medical directory and
you'll
find out that
What's his first name?
He's pioneered. Sorry?
What's his first
name? Hang on, I'm not getting into this. I'm not going to be bothering a man who's contributed so much to the extension of life to so many people.
You're not willing to put the doctor up.
This is the same hospital and the same ward which was founded by the legend Dr. Magdi Yacoub.
Oh, yeah.
Sir Magdi.
Yeah.
Sir Magdi.
A good man, Magdi.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, we'll get him on the show then.
No. You see, these guys...
He's not shy of a bit of publicity.
These guys don't go around seeking publicity. They just do good in life, unlike you.
Yeah.
You know, spread vermin and disease and all this kind of stuff. You know what I mean?
Pestilence, you forgot. Now, listen, we've got Simon Johnson on the phone
here. Talk to him.
So let's talk to him, because he's been waiting very patiently. And Mr. Jose Mourinho is once again in the spotlight. Simon, very good morning to you.
Morning, Chaz. I was actually enjoying that, because it was something different to what I've basically been putting up with for the last 2 or 3 months.
Simon, you said listen to the show, but we're off just what we do, you know, because you can't just talk about what's going on at Chelsea every single day, can you?
No. But, Simon, listen, if you think we've gone bonkers, maybe Jose's gone bonkers. He suddenly gets knocked out of a competition tonight, but for the first time this season, tells us all his team was magnificent.
Well, I wouldn't say they were magnificent. They played quite well, but they still lost, and that's all that matters.
Well, he also didn't blame the referee, which is unusual.
Yeah, that makes a change. Yeah, that was a positive.
Well, do you think somebody's had a word with him? Do you think somebody said, right, come on, Joe, so we've had enough of all the, you know, all the dreadful stuff and going down the corridor, the tunnel and bothering referees and all this, you know, you've got to turn it round and say something nice tonight. So he has.
I'm sure that message has been relayed, but he won't always... listen to what people say to him. I mean, what was noticeable, I was actually in the mix zone at the end of the tunnel, and technical director Michael Emanalo was there shaking hands with all of the match officials and telling them what a great game they had. So it did look like a bit of a charm offensive that he was very keen to sort of make nice, given what's happened over the last few months.
I should imagine so.
Well, he must realise, mustn't he, Simon, that you can't continually fight the sort of revolution against the oncoming tide of everybody else being against you. It just doesn't work.
Well, it's backfired spectacularly, you have to say. All this whinging, which you've got to remember, dates back to last season as well, where he's going on about a campaign If anything, Chelsea now get less decisions than before he opened his mouth. Mm. And look, you know, every club can sit there and moan about decisions going against them. And Chelsea have had a few, but it's not the reason why Chelsea are in the position they're in. They just haven't been good enough at both ends of the pitch. And really, Mourinho would be better off concentrating on putting that right than trying to fix the supposed injustice that he thinks are going on in the, with match officials.
Mm. I mean, do you have your own particular theory, everybody else has, about what's going on behind the scenes here, Simon, and how it's going to resolve itself? See, I think that if Mr. Abramovich is serious about the long-term future of the club, he's just got to say to Jose, hasn't he, look, it's been a disaster this season, write it off and let's start planning for next season here now.
Yeah, I just don't think Abramovich is that kind of guy to write seasons off. I think he will rightfully look at that squad and say, even if it doesn't win trophies, it should be in the top four and qualifying for the Champions League. And you have to say that if they lose at home to Liverpool on Saturday, where
yeah, but
like,
they won't, will they? Will they? In all honesty, do you think they will? I mean, Liverpool are still searching for some semblance of of inspiration under their new manager after 3-1-1 draws. I don't know why people think there's a chance that Liverpool will overturn Chelsea on Saturday. I don't think it'll ever happen.
Well, I think when you look at the fact that Palace and Southampton have gone there, and you might argue that they're better sides than Liverpool at the moment, but the point is that Chelsea are no longer a team to be feared wherever they play, and opponents know that. And Liverpool, put it this way, that they all go to Chelsea on Saturday thinking that they can actually roll Chelsea over, because, look, make no mistake, the atmosphere at Chelsea is going to be very tense. The players are going to be feeling the pressure because they know that lose this game and Mourinho may be on his way.
And also, professional footballers being what they are, knowing how, you know, referees' decisions are getting up their noses at Chelsea, they will be trying to get the referee involved in the game as much as possible, won't they?
Well, if... Like I said before, I don't think that tactics work for Chelsea. I mean, funny enough, they actually got...
No, but I'm saying it will work for Liverpool. They'll be trying to wind up any situation they can to get the referee to make any kind of decision, which is likely to get to Jose Mourinho even more.
Yeah, quite possibly. Although Liverpool may have suffered the setback in that the one of the biggest agitators on the pitch, Diego Costa, might not be there because he went to hospital due to a rib injury. So there's one guy down in terms of someone that they would have targeted to wind up. I just think, you know, Liverpool can, despite, they've yet to win on the clock, but they're going to be in a far better mood than Chelsea are, especially given the way that they lost this evening despite a reasonable performance. And of course, Eden Hazard, once
missing
again...
Missing another penalty.
He just looks short of confidence.
There goes the Ballon d'Or.
And I don't think we'll be hearing Mourinho saying he's playing better than Ronaldo as he did in pre-season. He showed some flashes of his old self, a bit like Chelsea as a whole. But again, there's just no end product, just like Chelsea. And you sort of wonder how he can lift himself.
Well, it's the first time I've actually been able to use that phrase that people use all the time.
What's that?
You know, would he be able to play on a cold Tuesday night in Stoke? Tuesday night in Stoke.
How cold was it?
It was colder than it would have been in Barcelona.
No, it wasn't.
Well, the weather report now? Give me the weather report.
Yeah. Well, if you're going to make statements like that, you know, the definitive, you know, I know everything type statement,
that
then
wasn't my point.
You need to back it up with facts. Simon, perhaps you could tell us...
Well, it was a Tuesday. Perhaps it was a night time.
Yeah.
It was cold.
Yeah.
And it was at Stoke.
Yeah, I know.
Any more facts you need?
Yeah, you've been munching too many biscuits, which you've got in the studio here. You've got too much sugar in your body and you're talking absolute bolloxio, which is short...
It's a place in Mississippi,
Shorthand for other words. Now, Simon, what I'm very concerned about, because I am an Englishman through and through, and I want us to do well. What's your problem?
An Englishman through.
Yeah.
With a Welsh name.
We're going to do very well at the championships in France next year. Why does Theo Walcott keep getting injured? Tell me what's going on, please.
Oh, he's one of these players like Jack Wilshere that just sort of seems to have a very fragile body that just keeps picking up knocks and question marks. Have to consistently be asked of Arsenal's medical department as well, because this happens year in, year out.
I know it does.
It's one of the factors why Arsenal always sort of flattered to deceive in terms of the title race because they can't keep their best players fit. And I mean, it's an absolute disastrous night for Arsenal. I mean, losing in the League Cup is okay, it's a bit embarrassing losing Sheffield Wednesday, but the much bigger blow was losing Oxlade-Chamberlain as well.
And Theo,
And Theo.
What is Theo supposed to... He's only on the pitch 13 minutes. What injury has he sustained, do you know?
I must admit, because I was at the Chelsea game, it passed me by a bit, but you know, it's with Ramsey, you know, he's out for a month with a hamstring, and Arsene Wenger admitted that he shouldn't have played him at Watford. You always suspected that in a way, the biggest sort of thing that could harm Arsenal and their title challenge would be Arsenal themselves, and you always sort of felt, well, are they a few more injuries away from it all going wrong? And certainly their fans will be fearing the worst this evening, that this could be a sign that it's all their good start of the season about to come off the rails. But it's a shame for Theo because he's just been showing at last that he's got the real
terrific potential to start up front for both England and Arsenal.
Well, Simon, listen, thank you very much.
Thank you, Simon. And sorry about the interruptions from the oaf on the left in the studio.
There's no need to apologise for me. Thank you very much.
I think there is. You're not going to apologise for yourself, are you?
Depending on which way you're looking into the studio, the oaf on the left could be you.
No.
It's a bit like the Leaning Tower of Pisa scenario. Now, according to my information, I can update you here. According to Arsene Wenger, he says that they are muscular injuries that both Alex Oxlade-Chamberlain and Theo Walcott have suffered, and they will have scans in the morning.
You pull a muscle, that's bad news, isn't it?
No, it's not good news, is it? Yeah. This is Talk Sport. We've got loads more to do. It's Ask Porky tonight, of course, and we're talking in the next hour to a man who wants to turn chickens into dinosaurs. This is Talk Sport.
Talk Sport.
He finds the corner of the net.
Extraordinary stamina, energy, and skill. Get your tickets now. Talk.
Two mics, we've got lots more coming up, including Ask Porky. We've got loads of great questions this week, actually, but if you want to get one in and you haven't sent one in yet or had one read out on the air, send it at the two mics.
Yeah.
Where you can follow us away. You'll also get all sorts of information about the live shows that we do. Our website, thetwomics.co.uk.
Yeah.
And all sorts of things coming up, including a video that we talk about, DVD rather, in a little while.
Well, the DVD's nearly ready now. Yeah. And I'm sorry, kids, that we've teased you about
this. It's just a bit of red tape that we have to get.
It had to go through post-production and all that kind of stuff. But we are, I promise you, going to make it available.
Yeah. They couldn't make us look any better.
No, they couldn't make us look any better, no. They've used as much photo technology as they possibly can. But I think we'll have it out by the latest early next week.
Well, that'd be great. Let's hope so. Fingers crossed. Now, a couple of tweets for you. Rob says this. Yet again, Porky has been robbed in Winners and Losers by OMG blatantly cheating. It's a fix. Ha ha. I don't know why anybody thinks I cheat. I really don't. Mm. John says, Everton have never won the League Cup, but lost to Aston Villa, not West Ham. Drew 1-1, then lost the replay 3-2 at Old Trafford, 1976-77.
Yes, that's the one I'm talking about.
Bevo says, it's a good job Winners and Losers doesn't go on footy for, otherwise Mike Parry would be getting the sack and having to apply for the Leeds job.
Why? For what?
Well, because your form is so bad, I think.
Oh, form, point. I see. Hey, listen, talking about Leeds and talking about Everton losing the League Cup, right? Yeah. Now, when I was the deputy sports editor of the Chester Chronicle...
What?
Right?
I don't think you ever were the deputy sports editor. You spent a lot of time stitching up the sports editor.
No.
That doesn't make you the deputy sports editor.
No, I was a normal reporter most of the time, but when Ian Bedford, who was the sports editor...
You don't have to give his name out.
He'd been there 40 years,
he's the guy that used to go home for a sandwich every lunchtime,
right? That's right.
Yeah, and then while he was at home with his wife, enjoying time with his family, you were busy, you know, roaming through his desk and gerrymandering anything that he was going on.
I used to ring a few people at Chester Football Club during the lunch hour, you know, just to prove that I was on the game, you know, 24 hours a day and all this kind of stuff.
Was it literally as soon as he went out the door?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah. And
you see, you've always been like this.
The manager of Chester FC was called Ken Roberts, who... I think I don't think he ever managed anybody else. I mean, he was that good, you know what I mean? Chester in the bottom of the fourth division.
Yeah.
And...
Dr. Roberts.
Yeah, Ken Roberts. And, you know, I shuttled down there once to see Ken, you know, behind Ian's back. Yeah. And he got very upset and all this kind of stuff. And said,
what was your explanation for that when he...
Just happened to be passing.
Yeah.
And, but anyway, the point of my story is, so he must have gone on holiday, although strangely I'm not sure why, because this was a League Cup tie at Sealand Road.
Yeah.
Now, Sealand Road was one of the grottiest grounds in the whole of the country.
Yeah.
It had a cinder, like cinders for... like the ground outside the ground, not inside the ground, you know what I mean?
So it's not even tarmac.
No, it wasn't even tarmac. Yeah. No, it's cinders. And the whole place was falling to pieces. Yeah. You know, the catering extended literally to two huts where the flap came up at the front and they served oxo.
Some people love all that, though. I mean, yeah, some people talk about that as the glory days of football.
I totally agree.
Before the kind of, you know, the £10-15
totally
hamburger and the
£5,
you know, half pint of beer.
That's right. But anyway, you've probably seen the film The Damned United about Leeds United in their pomp, right? Well, exactly the same thing happened. Chester drew Leeds United, who I think were league champions at the time. It was like 72, 73, something like that. You know what I mean? And the Leeds coach turned up, and then you saw these giants of football getting off at Chester, you know, Gordon McQueen.
Joe Jordan.
Gordon McQueen, Joe Jordan, Peter Lorimer, you know, Billy Bremner. Norman Hunter, and then the great Don Revie in his sheepskin coat.
Andy Gray.
There wasn't another Andy Gray. No. You're thinking of... I know what you're thinking of. You're thinking of... There were two brothers who played for Leeds United.
Was there not
United.
An Andy Gray that played for Leeds?
No, there was not an Andy Gray who played for Leeds. No, definitely not.
All right.
And anyway, put the story. So they come in and they go into the dressing room and all this kind of stuff. Chester miraculously beat them 3-0.
Wow.
Chester were in the fourth division. Right. Leeds were one of the best teams in Europe.
Right.
And Gary Talbot, who was Chester's lethal centre-forward, who incidentally was also a portrait photographer and took all the pictures of the Duke of Westminster on his 21st birthday, you know, the man who was chairman of the Board of Governors at the King's School, Chester, where I went, you know, very posh school.
Mm.
And we beat him 3-0, and it was the greatest night in the history of Chester Football Club. Unbelievable. So I know exactly how the Sheffield Wednesday fans are feeling tonight, having beaten Arsenal 3-0. But Chester were in an even lower league than Sheffield Wednesday.
Really?
When they completed this massacre of Leeds United. Yeah, it was absolutely terrific.
How extraordinary.
Now, listen, I want to ask you this question, OK?
Let me read you this. Andy Gray's playing days at Leeds United may not have been as fettered as those of his father, Frank, or Uncle Eddie. It was Eddie Gray, wasn't it?
Eddie Gray and Frank Gray.
Yeah, there you go.
But Andy Gray never played for Leeds.
No, but there was an Andy Gray, apparently, who has played for Leeds, but it was a different time.
Yeah, well, it must have been...
But it was Eddie Gray I was thinking of.
Eddie Gray,
the tall, skinny guy.
Eddie Gray was the incredible left winger with a great left foot, and Frank Gray was his brother who played at fullback.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely.
And they looked quite alike, didn't they?
They did look quite alike, and they were both
Scotsmen.
Now,
what was the point of the story you were telling me? Because I can't remember.
What?
When you were at deputy sports editor.
Well, I was saying
Chester.
I covered the game that night, didn't I?
Oh,
the 3-0 massacre when Chester beat Leeds.
Well, is that the story?
Yeah, it is the story.
That's the end of it.
Well, that's one of the great. That was one of the greatest upsets in cup football in the history of the League Cup.
Well, listen to
this. That's what I'm telling you.
Roy says this. If time travel is possible, maybe Porky should go back and find some better winners and losers. Hashtag plank.
Oh, yeah, that's very funny.
And Andy says, fantastic mathematics by Porky. Mm. Einstein born in 1879, theorised relativity when he was 30 in 1910 or 1911.
Yeah.
Surely 1909.
Well, it was about that time, wasn't it?
I think it was actually 1905.
1905, was it? Yeah, it was about that sort of time. He was quite bright as a young man, I suppose. Supposedly he was a young maths student or something, you know.
Lots of people posting pictures of your book for sale as well.
Oh, yes, yeah. Well, they've probably all got it and read it and probably overawed by it and that sort of thing. These sort of things happen. Now, what I want to ask you is this.
Somebody's actually posted Nicholas Banner as the doctor involved.
Dr. Nicholas Banner?
Yeah, is that your guy?
What, picture of?
Not a picture of him, no, just that's his name.
Oh, yes, his name, yeah, absolutely.
So how do they know that?
Well, I suppose there's not too many Dr. Banners around, you know, of that sort of magnitude. Anyway, do you feel stressed out?
Eh?
Do you feel stressed out?
I did yesterday.
Why?
When my car broke down.
Oh, when your car broke. Oh, you told them a development on that.
Oh, there is, yeah. I got a phone call from the bank in question saying that they were terribly sorry for the breakdown of the breakdown.
Now, this
business.
Is the bank that gives you a bank account and provides roadside recovery
That's
as well.
The very same, yeah.
That's amazing.
It
that,
is amazing,
That's a good deal. I like that.
It is a good deal.
Yeah.
And but, I mean, you know, you do pay them an amount of money for the services that they supply, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, they rang me up and it was a very nice Scottish woman from a sort of, you know, investigations
Hello, is that
agency.
You, Mr. Graham?
Her name was Emma, funnily enough.
Emma, hello, Mr.
And
Graham, it's Emma here.
Very apologetic about this whole thing. She said, but the thing is, normally people, we try and get a guarantee that they'll come within an hour. And I said, look, the issue was not how long they took, it was the fact that they said they would come within an hour and then didn't.
And they didn't.
Because we could have organised it through another, you know, breakdown.
Would have frozen to death in this lay-by.
Anyway, so they went through all the rigmarole and said, you know, as a sign of our willingness to try and compensate you for what your unhappiness and your... misadventure, we'd like to offer you a £40 payment.
Really?
And I went...
40 quid?
I said, are you having a laugh?
Yeah.
I said, £40? I said, my children have been traumatised, my dog has been traumatised. Yeah. I said, we've been sitting on the hard shoulder practically of a motorway for half a day.
Yes.
And you're offering me £40?
Mm.
And she said, well, you know, that's what we could offer you.
That's our standard rate.
I said, well, what if I don't want 40 quid? Mm. She says, well, then you can escalate the complaint if you wish. And I said, well, I think I do want to escalate the complaint. I said, what does that mean?
I mean, have you complained anyway?
I said to the guys on the phone during the day, I said, I want this complaint. I want to register a complaint because this is outrageous.
Yes,
that you're telling me a load of lies.
Yes.
No, whoever's fault it is, somebody's telling lies.
Yeah.
And so, anyway, so she said, well, if we escalate the complaint, you'll have to go to the senior management team. And I said, well, let's do that then. Half an hour later, she rings back.
Yes.
Offers me 75.
Wow. Did you turn that down?
No, I thought, well, I might as well take that.
Oh, all right. Okay, so you can be bought off for
£75. The main reason that I wanted to escalate the complaint.
How much did the last bottle of champagne cost that you bought?
Actually, I got it during Happy Hour. I did a deal, actually, in Happy Hour. I think it was £25.
25? Yeah. What about the one you bought that cost 70 quid recently?
That was ages ago.
Oh, yeah, a bottle of champagne, 70 quid.
Well, so now I've got a free bottle of champagne from the bank. What's wrong with that?
Well, yeah, that's the way
you judge
it.
That's the way I look at life.
That's the
way I look at life.
Don't you think that £75 should have gone into your young children's savings account at the Nationwide Building Society? To build for their future, that's why.
They don't need to build for their future.
No,
they don't need that.
What do you mean they don't need
it? Spend it on champagne.
Have you got a monthly account for your two boys where you put £5 in a month?
No.
Every responsible parent has a savings account for their children.
Well, what are they going to do with the £60 when they finally take it out at the end of the year?
So
buy themselves an Xbox game.
Just shut up a minute. So that when they,
it's not 1950.
So that when they get to 18 years of age, they've got the deposit for their first house.
18 times 60 is what?
About
less than £1,000. I don't think it's a lot of point, really.
Well, you used to be able to buy a house like that.
Yeah, I know. Maybe in Chester.
The Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast on Talk Sport with the new Ford Transit Courier. It's the breakfast show that doesn't compromise on delivering the biggest names from the world of sport.
Join me from 6 o'clock.
And cramming more into 4 hours every morning than you thought possible. The Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast. Weekday mornings from 6 on Talk Sport with the new Ford Transit Courier, the new small van with an impressive 1.63-metre load length.
Over £1 million will be won by fans playing short-term fantasy football contests on mondogoal.com this Premier League season. With Mondo Goal's one-day and one-week leagues that pay out every match day, it's never too late to get started. Sign up for free today at mondogoal.com and be like Alex Hayward from London, who turned a £1 entry into £10,000. Plus, use promo code FOOTBALL to receive a bonus on your first deposit. mondogoal.com. Fantasy football, real cash.
Players must be 18 or over. Always gamble responsibly.
I'm here with Oliver Mangum, Applications Director at Fairfield Control Systems. Oliver, how has hiring apprentices improved your business?
Our apprentices have been essential to our business growth. Their knowledge and talent helped to bridge a skills gap. In 3 years, our company has doubled in size, and we have a 95% retention rate, and all 7 of our apprentices are now permanent members of staff.
Thousands of companies like Fairfield Control Systems are realising the value of apprenticeships. With a free recruitment service and the possibility of a grant of at least £1,200, there's never been a better time to hire an apprentice. Find out more at greatbusiness.gov.uk/apprenticeships.
Direct Line guaranteed to beat any public liability insurance quote for the same cover. Can your insurance do that? Search Direct Line Public Liability Insurance. New customers only. Qualifying criteria apply. Underwritten by UK Insurance Limited.
Great deals this week on Toyo Tyres at blackcircles.com.
I saved £60 on my Toyo Tyres. And I got triple Tesco club card points.
I saved £90 on my Toyo tyres, and I could win a supercar experience at Silverstone.
Great prizes and up to triple Tesco club card points with Toyo tyres at blackcircles.com. Just enter your reg number, choose your tyres, then select a time and place to have them fitted that's convenient to you. Visit blackcircles.com to click fit and save. Savings compared to RRP.
The following offer applies to new Mercedes-Benz SUVs ordered between the 2nd and the 8th of November 2015. 3 years free servicing is based on three services over 36 months. No cash alternative. When you buy a brand new Mercedes-Benz SUV, your first 3 years of servicing are taken care of for free. So, while you're on your three camping trips, your dozens of takeaway pickups,
they forgot the poppadoms,
or your hundreds of school runs,
Daddy, why is that cow climbing on his friend?
You can rest assured that your Mercedes-Benz SUV will be running like it's brand new. for no extra cost. Visit our SUV event at your local retailer from the 2nd to the 8th of November. Unmissable offers for Mercedes-Benz.
Have a bagful of ridged radio entertainment on the warm-up on Talk Sport with McCoy's, official crisp partner of the Football League. Every Sunday morning from 11, Max Rushton tears open 2 hours of full-flavoured football fallout.
I've never seen you demonstrate such passion before.
And crisp conversation. It's a thick cut of real sports radio for real fans of sport. The warm-up on Talk Sport Sunday morning from 11 with McCoy's. Grab a bag in-store for a chance to win the ultimate fan experience. Be the real McCoy.
The Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast.
And ripping off his shirt to show his boxer's physique, complete with impressive six-pack.
This morning from 6.
A bit like yourself, John.
On Talk Sport.
Talk Sport, we are the two mics, and coming up later on in this hour, we're going to be speaking to a paleontologist about dinosaurs.
He thinks that
he's going to be able to recreate a dinosaur using the DNA of a chicken, which is pretty exciting stuff. He's out in Montana University, out in the Wild West country. Now, a couple of tweets and texts to read out to you.
Yeah.
Here's one. Do you remember last night there was a guy who was getting very worked up about our James Bond conversations?
Yes.
His name was Mike.
Yes.
He's actually sent in an apology. So, since he's been good enough to do that, we should read it out. He says, "Hey guys, I was a bit abusive to you last night about your lack of knowledge of the current James Bond films.
Yes.
I was a bit bladdered and you really wound me up because you didn't have a clue what you were talking about. Even so, that is no excuse for some of my language. I'm very sorry, Mike and Mike."
Yeah, bladderation is never an excuse to be abusive, you know. I mean, we've learned that over the years. But however, good enough of you to apologise. We accept it.
I think if somebody's big enough to apologise,
we accept it.
This is obviously a spoof one that's coming, and it's supposedly from Mr. R. Mugabe, and says, Dear Mr. Graham, I've heard from a corrupt official who used to work in football and now dabbles in the media, that you are incredibly skilled in fixing results in votes. A pupil of Mr. Gerrymander, I believe.
Yes.
I've even heard you can do this in your sleep. Please get in touch, as I would love to enlist your expertise.
Yeah, well, that wouldn't surprise me at all.
Yeah, very funny.
Listen, there's this big row going on about tax credits, right?
Yeah, there is, yeah.
You know, it's so complicated. But basically, it's whether or not you subsidise people's wages.
Yeah,
isn't
which
it?
Which is the stupidest idea I've ever heard.
Well, I totally agree. But, I mean, it started under one government, it's now passed to another, and now if the current government takes them away, people get poor. Or if they're used to it and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
However, what I think is really funny element of it is that the House of Lords, the peers in the House of Lords, decided to block it. So they, you know, this is now a political row going on.
Yeah.
But you know, the members of the House of Lords, a lot of them are very, very wealthy. And so, you know, they're actually deciding on whether people can have, say, up to £2,000 a year extra money or something like that. But the funniest one, I think, not that there's anything funny about the position he found himself in, is Lord Lloyd Webber.
Yes.
Andrew Lloyd Webber, Lord Lloyd Webber, who I sort of know of a little bit.
What do you mean you know of?
Well, through my friendship with Mr. Kenwright, not as Everton chairman, but as one of the world's biggest theatre impresarios,
yes.
I sometimes go to these first nights.
Oh, yeah.
You know, with a selected group of people.
You never invite me along to any of these either, do you?
No, I wouldn't take you along. You'd lower the tone of the place.
You have no interest in first nights.
You would
what
just
are you
lower
about?
The tone. Well, the parties afterwards are always very good.
Yeah, you go to the party.
Very lavish.
But you have to sit through about 3 hours of some show, right?
No, they're usually only about an hour and a half long. That's the deal. I always go to the ones that are quite short.
Yeah.
And
what
quite
a coincidence.
Often. Sorry?
What a coincidence.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. And quite often Lord Lloyd Webber's there, you know, and chat to him. But what's happened is that he's got
what
himself.
What do you talk to Andrew Lloyd Webber about?
The West End.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and
well,
how healthy ticket sales are and how good his shows are. You know,
so
I like
you
to
do a bit creepy, you know.
Oh, yeah, I like to tell him how good his shows are. Yeah.
When was the last Andrew Lloyd Webber show you went to?
I've never seen one, actually. but that doesn't matter, does it? You know that they must be good, because lots of other
he
people go to see
them. He must know that you're a complete charlatan.
No. He likes to talk to me about the media, you know, and what do I hear and,
well,
his, and all that kind of stuff.
Well, your old editor, of course, is his PR man, isn't he?
Nicholas, yeah, he is, yeah, that's right, yeah, yeah. No, he is, yeah, he's PR man. And Elton John's, actually.
Yeah.
Anyway, so old Lord Lloyd Webber, I don't know what his view on it all is, but people are, you know, contacting him now and saying, you know, if you don't agree with me on tax credit, I'm going to boycott all your shows. I mean, that's a terrible thing to
This is where we now are with all of these kind of, you know, these flash mobs and, you
know,
social media revolutions and the way that people want to boycott things.
Yeah.
And, you know, companies get forced into climb downs on various, you know, situations because because yes. the people have spoken, you know, which is in some ways good, but in some ways absolutely and utterly barmy and bonkers.
It's also...
Did you hear that story tonight, by the way, that Ben was reading
out? It's anti-democratic as well.
Well, you could say that, yeah, because, of course, the loudest and the noisiest people always get their way.
That's right, yeah.
In what, you know, that, which is why, despite the fact that some people don't like the idea that the Tories are in charge of the government, they happen to get the most votes of all the other parties.
Yeah,
that
exactly,
happens to be how it works.
Yeah.
When people say, oh, yeah, but they didn't get the most votes in the country, that's not the point.
No.
They got the most votes under the current system that we have.
Yeah, in the voting system that is available to everybody in this country, they got the most votes.
And there was a study done. Do you know how surprised everybody was when they won? Because nobody thought they would win.
That's right.
And an awful lot of the basing of those preconceptions was done on social media.
Yeah.
And what they've worked out, I saw a study the other day, what they've worked out is that Twitter is by far and away more organised by people on the left than it is by people on the right.
Right.
So whenever there is a sort of a Twitter, you know, sort of spat about something, it looks as though, and whenever they do Twitter polls, it always appears as though Labour are doing a lot better than they actually are.
Exactly.
Because there are many more people on Twitter who vote Labour than there are in the country proportionally.
I mean, I find it odd that why are activists on the streets always people from the left side of
Well, they
of
tend to be, don't they?
But they always are.
I suppose they're a far-right activist as well.
Well, yeah, but hang on. Do you ever, for all the years that Labour in power, did you ever see the Tories marching up and down Whitehall and smashing up the gates of Downing Street in order to protest against the fact that, once again, the middle classes have been landed with another carbon tax or something like that?
Well, the middle classes are too busy working, basically, to try and actually demonstrate better.
Well,
I
mean,
what about that story?
That's a bit unkind.
Oh, it's not unkind.
It's a bit unkind. You're having a go at the working man.
I'm not having a go at the working man.
I represent the working people of this country.
You do not represent the working man at all. Man of the People is a sort of comedy hashtag that you now have attached to your name.
Excuse me.
But what about that story that Ben was reading out a bit earlier about the smoking and the poverty, right?
Yeah.
Because I've been banging on for ages about this poverty line, which is now set at 19,500. Apparently, if you make 19,500 a year with a family of four, you're now living below the poverty line.
That's
They've
right.
now discovered
You tell that to somebody who lives in certain parts of India.
Yeah, Sumatra.
Or China. Yeah, or, yeah
well,
whatever, yeah.
Somebody else, they've come out with this study now that something like 400,000 people in these families living below the poverty line are smoking.
Yeah.
And if they gave up smoking, they wouldn't be below the poverty line anymore.
How much is a packet of fags now?
Well, it's about £10, more or less. You don't get much change out of a tenner.
So if they smoke just 20 a day, that's £140 a week.
Yeah.
And if you put the tax on top of that normal people pay, that's £200 a week.
Yeah.
That's another £10,000 a year.
Yeah,
so that would take their salary to £30,000 a year, which is a very respectable salary.
But they're classified as living below the poverty line, even though they can afford to spend that much on cigarettes. I mean, I know there will be no doubt loads of people who now give us lots of abuse for talking about, you know, right-wing politics and being, you know, Thatcher lovers and all that.
No.
But, you know, it is an absolute
Well, they give you
situation.
Abuse, but people do know I am the voice of the working man.
They do know that at all.
Listen, talking about the working man, did you know or are you aware of the fact there is a massive shortage of lorry drivers in this country?
No, but I'll tell you what there
massive.
Is. I'll tell you what there is a massive shortage of, which I want to talk to you about.
Yeah.
Pine nuts.
Who cares?
Pine nuts is the main constituent of pesto. You don't like pesto,
do you? No, who cares? Who cares? That's an elitist food.
You came out once, I seem to remember, and started banging on about the shortage of hazelnuts.
Yes,
I did.
Which
is going to lead to
a Ferrero Rocher shortage,
which turned out not to be true. Are you going to tell me that Ferrero Rocher is not a luxury food item?
Yeah, but only at Christmas.
Elitist.
Only at Christmas. Because it's, and by the way, a lot
Why are you not interested in a shortage of pine nuts?
Because it's irrelevant. A lot of working people, a lot of hard-working, working-class people buy themselves one box of Ferrero Rocher at Christmas to celebrate.
What sort of world do you live in? Just after they've saved up a pound a week or something?
No. After the Christmas lunch, they say, oh, look, we've got a bit of a treat Christmas Day, and they get the box of Ferrero Rocher out, and they undo the gold paper off them and stuff them in their gob.
Do you really think
and
that people...
think, you know, oh, this is nice.
Do you really think that people live like they did in the Christmas Carol or in, you know, sort of the old curiosity shop?
Well, hang on. What do most normal people these days do then after their Christmas lunch? Say, oh, I tell you what, let's have 3/4 an hour now on our computers and play one of those hideous games where people get massacred and all that kind of stuff.
They might do, but the point is the world has moved on from somebody saying, oh, look, we've got a great treat for you.
I'm trying to tell you.
The ambassador's chocolates are here. Yeah. We've managed to splash out just for this one time a year to get you all a bit of Ferrero Rocher.
That's what Christmas Day is meant for.
Rubbish.
That's what Christmas Day is meant for.
Have you any idea how much the average family in this country spends on Christmas?
Quite a lot.
Thousands.
Yeah.
Thousands. It's not about a special treat. You're right. When I was growing up, it was a special treat to have some after eights.
Sometimes we'd
have them on a Saturday
For
night.
For some unknown reason.
While Match of the Day was on.
My mum used to buy a little box in a funny sort of shaped box of dates at Christmas.
Yeah, dates. Yeah, figs as well.
God, who would want to eat those?
With a stick.
With a stick.
Yeah. Dates are great. They're really nice in your cereal, actually.
And she used to get these walnuts, and to break into the walnuts, she had like a massive, great, you know, nutcracker.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, the size of a, you know, the size of a.
It's true.
A farm implement.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
That's right. Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Like the thing that you used to neuter bulls with.
That's right. Yeah.
But the thing is, right, in the end, that's all gone now. That is not the case
hasn't
anymore.
Hasn't gone in our house.
Everyone is spoiled rotten
hasn't
now.
Hasn't gone in our house.
Everyone is spoiled rotten.
We like a traditional Christmas, you know. But the thing is, a lot of things...
You told me you spend most of Christmas Day in the larder, drinking.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't.
You said you slip into the larder because that's where the wine's kept.
Yes.
And you stay in there for quite some time.
I didn't say that.
Knocking
at all.
It all back.
No. But what I'm saying is,
because
of the shortage of lorry drivers, there's going to be a lot of Christmas goods that won't be around this year. We need more lorry drivers.
No, we don't.
I'm thinking of buying a lorry.
Well, Chris Eubank was on earlier. He's thinking of buying one.
He's
had one, hasn't he?
He's got one, yeah.
What do you make of his new name?
English.
Like
Johnny English?
Yeah, like English mustard.
English mustard, yeah.
Yeah. Very strange.
English.
This is Talk Sport. More coming up.
Talk Sport on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
Freedom for sport.
Can we kick it? Yes, we can. Talk Sport.
Well, we are the two mics. There will be a podcast coming out a little bit later on, probably about 7 hours or so from now. Now, we normally play that song when Tim Vickery's coming on.
You do, actually,
it's all about going down to
Rio. But the line I love in that is, what's your name? Virginia Plain.
Yeah.
And that was the first Brian Ferry album.
Yeah.
Roxy Music.
Yes.
And it was so stylish and unbelievable. And he had on the front of it a lady with incredibly long blonde hair on her hands and knees in like a sort of is it a zebra type outfit?
Yeah, sort of animal print.
Animal print, that. And she was crawling through this sort of exotic garden.
Yeah.
And that was Jerry Hall.
Yeah.
And that was the first the world ever saw her. She was a 21-year-old model from Texas.
Yeah.
And she was 6'2" tall.
Yes.
And she was Brian Ferry's girlfriend.
And later lured away by Mick Jagger.
Mick Jagger walked into the hotel bedroom one morning, I have read, and Brian Ferry and Jerry Hall were in bed, and he shook the end of the bed, you know, and said, come on, you two, get up, you know, it's time to play and all that.
Yeah.
And a few weeks later, she left Brian Ferry and shacked up with Mick Jagger.
Yeah.
And they have three children together?
I believe so, yeah.
Three children.
It's quite hard to keep up with all the kids Jagger's got, to be honest.
Yeah.
But you see that story this week that apparently she's now being romanced, for want of a better word, by Rupert Murdoch?
It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Rupert Murdoch, the most famous media mogul in the world and one of the most successful. A man is a self-made...
84 years of age.
Billionaire, 84 years
of
age.
Not bad, is it? If you're still actually chasing women at 84.
Absolutely. Who separated and then divorced his wife, Wendy Deng, after hearing that the former Prime Minister of this country, the UK, Tony Blair...
Yeah, and godfather to his children.
And godfather to his children, visiting Wendy Deng at one of their homes in California, unbeknown to Mr. Murdoch.
Yeah.
What does that tell you?
Well, I mean, there were some very, very serious allegations made. I'm not sure how many of them were true. But,
well, we're not going to repeat them on this station because we're a family... family show.
But certainly there were suggestions of Rogerisation, I can say that.
Well, I wouldn't go that far. Yeah. I would not go that far.
Well, there were suggestions, and I don't know whether that's true.
Well,
but anyway.
I don't think we should get there. I don't think we should go in that territory. Anyway, the point is...
But anyway, certainly there was enough to split them up. But supposedly he's now sort of courting Ms. Jerry Hall.
Well, reports coming from America say they're, quotes, a number, that they've been to Broadway shows together.
Yeah.
And that...
Maybe they've met Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Sorry?
Maybe they've met Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Maybe they have. He's a very important man in the theatre world.
Mm.
And Ms. Hall is... who, by the way, married Mick Jagger, but then found out later that the marriage, which took place, I think, in Costa Rica...
No, it was Bali, wasn't it?
Bali?
Yeah, it was one of those marriages on a sort of exotic beach island.
I think it was on Bali. Yeah. Later had no...
I'll tell you why I know that, is because George Gordon, our old mate from the Daily Mail...
That's right, yeah.
..went out there for the wedding.
Did he?
Yeah, I think so.
Amazing. But it had no basis in law, and so it was nullified.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, because Mick Jagger, again, so the rumour mill goes...
Yes.
..is not over-generous with paying out money to
Apparently
people.
Apparently not.
And so he decided to get his lawyers involved and just say to her, well, look, you know, you can say how much money you want... All you like.
Mm.
I'll look after you. I'll give you this, but I'm not giving you that.
That's right.
And if you press it further, I'll just say the wedding didn't ever happen.
It didn't happen, apparently, according to the lawyers now, and it never took place. But anyway, that's...
She says, I'd like to settle down with someone, but I haven't met the right person yet since I got divorced from Mick.
Well, there she goes. I mean, it's
surely hard. She wouldn't marry an 84-year-old. She's only 59.
Well, I've no idea. I mean, I don't really want to get involved in Mr. Murdoch's private and personal life.
Why not?
I mean,
he gets involved in everybody else's.
Yeah, but if you've achieved what he's achieved in his life, right, then you have different levels of energy and ambition at 84 to normal people. Because he's not normal, he's a Superman.
Yeah.
I mean, to be a self-made billionaire who created, like, literally created television networks out of nothing in the world's most competitive TV market, America, you've got to be something special.
Yeah, oh, I don't disagree
with
that.
There we are.
But I think equally he also knows that he's a massively large personality and therefore he's going to suffer the ignominy of being talked about and being written about and being photographed whenever he's with somebody of interest.
Maybe. Now then, let's not in any way connect Mr. Murdoch being 84 with the story I'm going to talk to you about now, but it's about drink, right? Oh, yeah. Which in a report a month ago was said to be the cause of dementia in people who still drank socially in middle age.
Uh-huh.
They got dementia when they got older. Right. A new report
well,
now.
Well, didn't that one say more or less that you shouldn't drink really very much throughout your life?
Well, it's certainly in your middle life.
Yeah.
So by the time you get to about 26, 27, give it up altogether and then don't start again until you're about 55.
Right.
Because the drinking in your middle years gives you dementia. Anyway, you won't believe this. I've come across another report which says completely the opposite. It says drink prevents dementia. It's the opposite of what we're told, but a top science writer says evidence shows alcohol doesn't harm your brain, it actually protects it. Mm. Right?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, isn't that amazing?
Well, why is it amazing?
Well, because
I mean, every time there's one of these studies that comes out, right?
Yeah.
There's another study that comes out either a week later or a year later or 2 years later, which completely contradicts it. I mean, we've had the drink one glass of red wine a day to stave off cancer, drink one glass of white wine a day.
That's right.
You know, eat three bananas, you know, have real butter, don't have real milk.
That's
have
right.
skim variety. You know, it's all nonsense.
Of course,
it's all
nonsense.
It's like that one that they came out with the other day about the processed meats, you know. Which we, I don't think
oh, yeah,
we
don't eat sausages and bacon because you get cancer.
Bacon,
rubbish.
You know, corned beef. It turns out that even The Guardian, who would normally be the great supporters of the World Health Organization, actually questioned them as to where their evidence was. They didn't have any.
No.
All they said was, well, it could increase your risk of getting cancer.
Yeah, because it
carcinogens.
Well, so
could walking around.
I
mean, everything gives you cancer if you talk about increasing the risk.
Listen to this. With access to 150 years' worth of medical journals stored in the Royal Society of Medicine's magnificent library in London, this scientist found out that one of the earliest studies looking at the effect of moderate alcohol intake on dementia had been done in the 90s. In this study, US researchers kept tabs on 6,000 women aged over 65 and found that drink and its consumption actually helped improve their mental state, not retard it.
I think you'd have to be of the opinion, I suppose, that if you drink quite heavily, then you are going to forget stuff. Because, I mean, when you are in a state of bladderation and when you are in a state of hungoverness,
that's right.
Basically your brain doesn't work very well.
No, well,
so it's bound to be damaged in the long term.
Yeah, temporary memory loss, but then during the course of the day after, if you see what I mean, things suddenly jog in your head.
Well, they do. But what I'm saying is,
you get a message from somebody saying, oh, it was great to.
What do you mean by calling me such a horrible name in the middle of the night?
Yeah, or you get something like, you know, have you ever had that one where you found the bill in your pocket, you know, like sort of 2 or 3 o'clock the following day, and it's for like 240 quid, and it's from an Indian restaurant, and then you realise you took 6 friends with you to an Indian restaurant?
No, I've never been that drunk.
You know, and had maybe.
I've never been that drunk.
Maybe 8 bottles of wine and you know, 6 chicken curries and all this kind of stuff.
No, but that's because you're very generous in that way, which is one of the few things I will say in your favour.
Oh, really? It pains you to say that, does it?
Well, it does pay me to say it, because I don't want to give people the wrong impression. But you are very often the first one to put your hand in your pocket.
Well, I do that.
If there's a large group of people.
I do that because I can't. Do you know why I do that, Mike?
My favourite story about that, though, is the one time when you and I went for a drink in the city. To join David Ginola, Mr. Brazil, and you had bought some wine.
Yeah.
And when you went to pay for it, you were presented with a bill which was substantially larger than the amount of wine that you'd actually bought.
It's right. It was Mr. Brazil's monthly bill, which they thought that I would settle for.
He must have told them that you were going to settle it for
him. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe. we'll just say it was a misunderstanding.
It was a misunderstanding, clearly.
Yeah. But no, the reason I do that is I cannot stand the sense of tension. You know, you're all standing there.
And also,
right,
what's worse
drink?
Often is
so
what's
I always
worse.
Say, right, come on, I'm in the chair, what are we having?
But also, what's worse, is it not, is at the end, when you're out with people who then decide they want to split the bill about 15 different ways.
Oh, forget it.
It's just appalling.
I just can't be bothered.
Yeah.
And that's why I won't eat in big groups. I won't eat in group of eight or anything like that, because at the end, somebody's always, well, you know, I only had one glass of wine.
Yeah.
And all that. I just can't be bothered.
I know, shocking.
I just simply... And I can't stand the waiter saying, now, whose is the sirloin? Oh, no, you give me the wrong food and all that. Forget it. You've invented this expression, me, table for one.
Yeah.
Believe me, a table for one is a lot less trouble and a lot more efficient than a table for six.
I haven't invented it. It's what you have.
One time when I was on the Chester Chronicle, right, there's a booze we used to use after work, you know, and this guy came in from the other paper. There were two papers, Chester Chronicle and Cheshire Observer. And he always had a reputation of being a bit mean.
Yeah.
But he came in with this young lady, who was, I think was a new reporter at the paper or something like that. And they stood by the bar for a good 90 seconds. Mm. She'd expected this guy, you know, as a gentleman, to sort of say, what are you drinking?
All right.
So
he never offered.
He never offered. And it was pathetic. And do you know what? I'll never forget the shame of the incident.
Yeah.
She suddenly said, should I get the drinks then? Yeah. You know, she didn't know what was going on. It was her first day on the job and all that.
Goodness.
And,
not good.
And do you know what he said? I'll never forget this. He said, would you mind, please? I've only got a 20 and I don't want to break into that.
Dear me.
And I
thought... What a complete loser.
I thought, I hate you, you know. And anyway, I got chatting up to her a bit later on and told her we're not all like that, because I thought he'd given the whole newspaper industry in Chester a terribly bad name, you know.
Did that help you?
Sorry?
Did that help you?
Help me what?
With her.
Oh, yes.
Did it?
Oh, yes. Really? Yes, substantially.
Really?
Yes.
Extraordinary
stuff. Absolutely.
This is Talk Sport.
Oh, I've gone bankrupt a few times trying to prove to ladies how generous I am.
Yeah.
Without a shadow of a doubt.
Yeah, well, it's all right if it works, though.
It's all right if it works, but then you end up with no money, you know, and then you have to go and borrow it from your mum's gas bill envelope upstairs.
Have you been steal it?
No, borrow. No, my mum knew about it. Always paid it back.
Oh, OK. Mm. This is Talk Sport. Coming up next, we're going to talk to Dr. Jack Horner. That's one of the great names. He's a paleontologist. He's going to tell us about dinosaur chickens. This is Talk Sport.
Inspire the next generation of young fans and celebrate the spirit of the game on Talk Sport with Barclays, championing the true spirit of the game. Listen throughout the day for the chance to win a pair of tickets to take a young fan to their very first Barclays Premier League match. Win an unforgettable experience that will last a lifetime. Play first games on Talk Sport with Barclays, championing the true spirit of the game. For full terms and conditions, go to talksport.com/competitions.
Because road conditions change in a second, BMW's intelligent four-wheel drive switches power from rear to front wheels in just one-tenth of a second.
From rear
to front. From front
to rear. From rear
to front. Delivering grip that's almost magnetic. xDrive. Available on models across the range, including sports hatch, saloon, coupe and touring. To find out more, visit your local BMW centre.
This week, check out Asda's Toy Sale, with over 100 toys up to half price, including My Little Pony Twilight Sparkle and Rainbow Dash 2-pack, was £40, now £20. And Lego City 3-in-1 Value Pack, was £40, now £30. Lots of toys, so many savings. And heaps of fun, with the Asda Toy Sale. Available in-store and online at george.com. Asda. Save money, live better. Selected stores, lines and availability. Higher price charge, 59 stores.
The following offer applies to new Mercedes-Benz SUVs ordered between the 2nd and the 8th of November 2015. 3 years free servicing is based on three services over 36 months, no cash alternative. When you buy a brand new Mercedes-Benz SUV, your first 3 years of servicing are taken care of for free. So, while you're on your three camping trips, your dozens of takeaway pickups,
they forgot the poppadoms,
or your hundreds of school runs,
Daddy, why is that cow climbing on his friend?
You can rest assured that your Mercedes-Benz SUV will be running like it's brand new. For no extra cost, visit our SUV event at your local retailer from the 2nd to the 8th of November. Unmissable offers for Mercedes-Benz.
Vice called Halo 5 Guardians spectacular. Eurogamer named it the best sci-fi first-person shooter campaign in the business. And official Xbox magazine called it one incredible game. Join the greatest hunt in gaming history. Buy Halo 5 Guardians at Tesco now for only £35 when you buy selected Xbox Live cards and subs. Tesco. Every. Helps. PEGI 16. Terms and conditions apply.
The Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast on Talk Sport with the new Ford Transit Courier. It's the breakfast show that doesn't compromise on delivering the biggest names from the world of sport.
Join me from 6 o'clock.
And cramming more into 4 hours every morning than you thought possible. The Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast. Weekday mornings from 6 on Talk Sport with the new Ford Transit Courier. The new small van with an impressive 1.63 metre load length.
Get on the boat, everybody wants the dinosaur.
Talk Sport. We are the two mics. There will, of course, be a podcast coming out a little bit later on. And one of the very interesting things that you'll find on that podcast is the interview we're about to do with Dr. Jack Horner, Regents Professor of Paleontology at Montana University out there in Wild West Country. Mr. Parry, what this man wants to do is to create dinosaurs from chickens.
Why is that?
Well, let's find out why.
Absolutely.
Dr. Horner, very good morning to you.
Good morning.
Thanks very much indeed for joining us. Now,
indeed.
We've all watched Jurassic World. We've all seen Jurassic Park. We've all seen the way that, I suppose, some unexplained or discovered fossilised DNA was able to be used to create these creatures again. Presumably, you can't do that in real life, so you're going to do something else.
That's correct, yeah. We've been trying to get DNA out of a dinosaur for a long time, and it just doesn't last that long. Mm. But birds are their descendants.
Right.
They're evolutionary descendants, and so birds carry dinosaur DNA.
Mm. Why do we want to create new dinosaurs, Doc?
Well, it's sort of like I would pose the same question, why did anyone want to make a chihuahua?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I know, but a chihuahua can be sort of small and cuddly and you can put it on your knee in the back of your car and all this kind of stuff, but dinosaurs tend to have rather more aggressive tendencies.
Well, that's only in the movies. Yeah, it's going to probably have the same temperament as a chicken. I don't know that I'd want to carry a chicken around the back of my car either.
I actually used to have pet chickens when I was at university. We had two pet chickens, and they were very friendly, and they used to lay eggs, and they were actually quite.
Yeah, but hang on, we're talking about dinosaurs, man. You know, dinosaurs are things that go around sort of snatching lambs out of fields and eating them, and all this
stuff. Well, Dr. Hall has just said that's only in the movies. You have to get beyond the movies.
Right. That's right.
Okay, so what sort of dinosaur would you create? A domestic dinosaur? Could we end up having dinosaurs in the back garden? This kind of stuff.
Well, you know, the first one that we ever make is just basically going to look like a chicken.
Yeah.
You know, sort of like a chicken. It's just going to have a head that looks a little more like a dinosaur. It'll have a long tail. It'll have arms and hands instead of wings.
Could that be a very frightening image, that, for a child or something? You know, this is Dr. whatever name or stuff, isn't
it? Dr. Moreau, you mean?
Yeah, it's horrible stuff. I mean, you know.
Well, no, it's called discovering, and it's called science.
Oh, my God, it's frightening me already.
Is it? I mean, would it be the same size, life size, as a chicken?
Yes.
Hmm. Yeah, but again, I can't see the point in it. I mean, look, I admire your work and the fact that you want to go through this, Doc, but wouldn't you be better off creating an anti-cancer pill rather than messing around trying to create
he's
dinosaurs?
He's a paleontologist.
Yeah, I know. We have a little tree. Yeah, but I'm not sure how much good paleontologists do for the world.
Well, you know, again, we go back to domesticated animals. We, you know, they are animals we make as well. I mean, they're cats and dogs and anything that is domesticated, cows, pigs, you know, we have bred them. And it basically is the same process, except that, you know, by manipulating genes, we can just do it quicker.
Sure. And so would the experiment, if it was to be successful, the chickensaurus scenario, is it as an exercise, if you like, or would these creatures be more useful than chickens on their own?
I don't know. You know, you could sell them with Kentucky Fried Chicken and you'd have an extra part.
Yeah, I mean, you see, Doc, when you talk about this, you talk about
Kentucky
it...
Kentucky Fried Dinosaur. I like the sound of that.
Yeah, but you talk about it in sort of almost amusing terms. I mean, I kind of get the impression, without knowing you very well, that you're a sort of frustrated Indiana Jones who wants to go around the world discovering dinosaurs.
Yeah. Indiana Jones.
Yeah, you know, go around the world discovering dinosaurs, you know, brandishing a whip.
He was an archaeologist.
And finding lost tribes. Yeah, same sort of thing, though. Do you see what I mean, Doc?
Yeah, well, I travel the world, find lots of dinosaurs, and here's another project, a project to see if we can make a dinosaur.
Make a dinosaur, yeah. Well, a lot of people, a lot of ambitions to make a car, you know, or something that moves like that, but making dinosaurs...
I don't know what you're so frightened of.
Well,
you're frightened of progress, aren't you? That's what you're frightened
of. This is not progress. This is going back about 8,000 years.
This is a thing, Doctor. How many?
About 8,000 years.
About 8,000 years.
Yeah.
Dr. Horner, I think he is a bit frightened of progress. How far along are you with this project? How sort of close are you to getting this somehow on the road?
Well, we've... We're working on the tail right now, trying to figure out how the tail formed.
Yeah.
Basically, what we're doing is attempting to reverse some evolutionary processes, and I think we're about 50% there.
Okay. Well, that's quite exciting, really.
Hang on. So you're going to end up with a half chicken, half dinosaur beast, sort of, you know, flapping around in a field somewhere. Isn't that cruel that you'll have, you know, some...
No, it's already explained that birds already have the DNA of dinosaurs. They are the direct descendants of dinosaurs.
Yeah, but, I mean, if you've got a load of chickens and one of them looks like a dinosaur, the other chickens are going to attack the dinosauric chicken because it looks different.
No, but it'll have hands to protect itself.
Don't be ridiculous. I mean, this is all a bit of a fantasy world, really, isn't it? Hey?
It's not.
It is.
Why don't you let Dr. Horner speak?
Well, I'm trying to let him
speak. Is that right, Dr. Horner? Could the dinosauric chicken be bullied?
Well, I suspect it'd be the other way around. But
I think until
we make one, I don't think we're going to know that.
Yeah. With the DNA...
Did you see Jurassic World?
I haven't seen Jurassic World, no. Well, is it good?
It's got a genetically modified dinosaur in it.
Yeah.
You know,
and that goes horribly wrong, though. That goes horribly wrong, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, that would be a crappy movie if it didn't.
Yeah, I suppose
it certainly would. Doc, who funds all this kind of research? You know, where on earth have we got, you know, millions and millions of spare dollars to get involved in research turning chickens into dinosaurs? When, as I've said to you already in this interview, perhaps we could put it into medical research, which would help people, you know, recover from things like leukemia or something.
Well, actually, if we figure out how to make the tail of the dinosaur, it has great application for the medical field, and we will be able to help solve some problems with genetic spinal defects.
Well,
it's got a lot of practical. Got a lot of practical.
And also, I noticed that from some of the research I've been doing on this, that you're working on not necessarily recreating or making some kind of hybrid of a beast. You're actually going to try and unlock certain forms of DNA which might have just been turned off.
That's right, exactly.
Hmm. Yeah, okay. And how's
that? You see how that makes a difference? Because what it means is then it might well be that you could apply that to humans, and we could have, you know, hidden DNA that we're not really using.
I don't see that at all. How many people like you are there in the world, Doc?
What do you mean?
Let me answer
one of your first questions.
Yeah.
All of the funding comes from private donors.
Oh, so right.
Nothing comes from any tax money or anything like that. It's all private donations from people who are interested in our work.
So that you'd have to call them crazies, wouldn't you, to actually put your hand in your pocket and say, I'm going to give like, you know, $10,000 to a guy who says he can turn chickens into dinosaurs. You have to be off your rocker.
It'll come as no surprise to you, Dr. Horner, that I have in the past called my broadcasting partner, Mr. Parry, a member of the Flat Earth Society.
Yeah.
He's not in favour of any kind of exploration of space. He doesn't want to spend any money on anything which is of any interest to the human race at all.
No, I'm just a bit cynical about somebody who gets up every day and says, oh, I know what I'll do today. I think I'll turn a chicken into a dinosaur. I mean, it's very hard to accept.
Well, I could just get up in the morning and say, you know, I'm going to go to the lab and see if I can't fix spinal bifida.
Well, that would be good. That'd be good. That'd be excellent.
Well, no. I could do that instead.
Yeah, well, that would be excellent. Doc, I want to thank you very much indeed for your tolerance.
My apologies for some of the rather idiotic questions, Dr.
No, they were idiotic questions.
No apology necessary.
Okay, great. Thanks, Doc.
If I may, well, I mean, how soon do you think you'll make the next breakthrough? We can come back and chat to you again.
Well, you know, maybe I'll get the dinosaur made, and then maybe I'll start thinking about making a pink unicorn.
Okay, that's great. See you in the year 40,020. Thanks, Doc.
Excellent. Dr. Jack Horner, what a great name, and what an interesting man. I can't believe you were so rude to him.
I wasn't rude.
How many more people in the world are there like you?
Yeah.
How about all the people in the world? They're all like him.
No, they're not.
He's not, like, particularly different or freakish. Let me read you a couple of tweets
out here.
Oh, really?
So you've met people before who and you say...
He's a scientist.
Yeah, so what's your job? You say, I turn chickens into dinosaurs.
No,
I mean, it's a bit hard to believe.
He's a paleontologist who's working on a particular project. Yeah. Doesn't make him weird.
Paleontology is like, it's a dead art, because there aren't any dinosaurs around, so what are they studying?
Well, Well, there might well be some if this guy's project
rubbish.
Works.
What a
I think
nonsense.
You're just frightened.
What a nonsense.
You're frightened. You fear the unknown.
I don't fear
you
the unknown.
You fear the
mate.
Unknown. Here's one from
I
Chris.
I fear loonies who are going around trying to convince people that, you know...
You can't refer to him as a loony. He's
dinosaur.
He may have a good lawyer.
I didn't say he was a loony.
Chris says this. Voice of the working man, unless they live in a council house, of course. Mm-hmm. Hashtag plank. And then it says this from Ross. Family show, including rogerisation with married women, Fellaini's genitals, years of alcohol abuse, and that's just the tip of the iceberg.
Well, you know, you can find fault in anything you like in this world, but, I mean, you have to have a much, much broader canvas to be able to take it all in. By the way, have I told you about that stress makes you look uglier? Did you know that?
You were asking me if I was stressed out.
Yeah,
I don't think you finished the thought.
No, well, that's what it's all about. You need to know that.
Right.
You need to know that.
Okay.
And, by the way, it's no
well,
wonder...
What happens if you're ugly from the beginning?
Yeah, but you never get stressed, you see, because you know why?
I don't.
You're already pretty ugly, and you'd be fully ugly if you were stressed out. That's
fully
why you're
ugly.
So laid back, yeah.
Fully ugly?
Yeah, fully ugly.
What is that?
Well, that's like uglier than you are now, ugly mug.
Derek in Pencoed has been in touch.
Pencoed?
He says, Mike, Porky claims to speak for the working class, but always goes on about the car he drives. I'm working class, and he doesn't speak for me.
So oh, really?
Your pipe and smoke
What do you work as? We've found this out before, haven't we? What's
Derek's Derek? A cleaner.
Cleaner, that's right, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
You
yeah.
look down on him because he's
no,
a cleaner.
No. Obviously a profession with a big future. To get a mop.
Do you see what I mean? This is Talk Sport. More coming up.
Talk Sport.
Can I have your attention, please?
Get your kit on. Maybe not. On DAB, digital radio, and 1089 and 1053 AM. In a different league. Result.
Oh, thanks, Bob.
Talk Sport.
Talk Sport, we are the two mics.
Yeah.
That song sound familiar to you?
No.
No? Love Cats?
Love
That's
Cats.
That's called, yeah, by The Cure. Remember The Cure?
I remember The Cure, yeah. Love Cats. Now, funny you should say that, actually, because I was going to talk to you about this.
Yeah.
Black cats are very special.
Are they?
But people start
getting
spooked.
In a good way?
No, they get spooked by them.
Well, black cats are part of that whole superstition, aren't they? If a black cat runs across the road in front of you, it means you're going to have bad luck or good luck, depending on which book you read.
No, I always say it's good luck. I always say it's good luck.
Well,
I love to see black
bad
cats.
Luck. Bad
no,
luck.
No. Oh, no. I've always regarded a black cat. You see a black cat, it's a good sign of good luck.
Well, see, I was taught the other opposite way. That's what I'm saying. I mean, there are two versions, basically, of the black cat myth.
Well...
Either one, it's good luck, or two, it's bad luck.
Let me tell you this.
Right.
Because, of course, I donate to so many charities, I keep an eye on them all the
time,
right? I thought
you'd given all that up.
I have given a lot of it up, but I still get loads of literature through the
you don't want to be bothering with all that, do you?
No, anyway, look, one of them called Cats Protection. And in fact, I'm not very fond of cats. I'm fond of dogs.
Oh, hang on. I mean, this is the same Mike Parry, I believe, who was thinking about sort of, you know, spraying all sorts of noxious substances on that cat as he comes into your roof garden.
That's right, if it invades my garden and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, I did find out in the literature here, they're staging, would you believe, a National Black Cat Day, and I think it's next Tuesday.
Why?
Well, because the plight of the abandoned black cat is serious.
Why is it any worse than any other cat?
Because nobody likes to take on black cats.
No.
So all these cats' homes, you know, which have strays that they take in and all that, they can never get rid of the black cats.
Really?
No.
How surprising. Shouldn't they have it on Halloween?
Well, I don't know.
Wouldn't that make more sense? I mean, that would be a better sort of PR angle, wouldn't
it?
Yeah,
but wouldn't that sort of brand the black cat as sort of evil? And,
well, that's probably why they're not doing it.
Yeah, well, exactly, yeah.
Why don't you take one in then? A cat would be a perfect pet for you. I mean, you've talked about getting a parrot, you've talked about getting a tortoise, you've talked about getting fish. A cat is a perfect pet for you because you don't really have to do too much to look after it. It can spend long periods
of
time
evil.
On
cats
its own.
Cats are evil. They scheme against you.
What do you mean they're evil?
You can tell they're scheming
this
against you.
This is not going to help your campaign to save the black cat, is it? If you actually start the conversation with, by the way, cats are evil.
Well, I don't think black cats are evil. I think ordinary cats are evil. They get into your brain. They look at you and they, you know, you can tell that they're going to do you
down.
But
did you never have a pet cat as a child?
No, I'd never have had a pet cat. No, I don't like cats.
Well, why do you have such an aversion to them?
I don't know, but...
Did one scratch you or something?
No. I just think that they're so... remember, I read the book once called David Copperfield.
Oh, yeah.
And in that, there's a lawyer called Silas Marner. Uh-huh. And he goes, ever so humble, sir, ever so humble.
You're not thinking of Uriah Heep.
Uriah Heep, that's it. Yeah, that's the guy. Yeah, ever so humble, sir, ever so humble. And it said that he's got long, wet fingers, you know, which he rubs together like this. I'm ever so humble,
he's very
sir.
Oligenious.
Oligenious. Yeah. And I think that's what cats are. You see, I think they're like that because, you know, they can shake themselves into...
They're very self-centred.
Well...
And self-reliant. You don't need to do much to them.
And I honestly don't get on with cats at all. And but the only
you don't get on with anyone.
No, but the only sort of cat I could get on with would be a black cat. That's
well,
the point
I
am
understand the difference between a black cat and every other cat.
Because I think a black cat...
The only difference is the colour.
I think the black cat has been sort of cast out by the cat society, if you see what I mean. So I think it's
so
a bit of a...
So you have some kind of affinity.
Yeah, that's right, yes. Yeah,
but you haven't
thing.
Been cast out of any society.
No, I haven't, no,
surprisingly
definitely
Surprisingly enough.
No, I haven't.
Apart
no.
from by your own family when you were a child.
No.
You weren't able to go into those rides because there was three of you and there was always your two sisters.
Well, that's true.
So maybe that's what it's about.
Family of four could always get into, like, you know, a... what do you call it? A car on a fair ride.
Yeah, yeah.
And I always stood aside and said, no, go on, you two go to my sisters.
That's
a gentleman.
Well, you've told us that story.
Yes.
But I think
yes,
it may
have
affected you.
Anyway, look, to celebrate the Black Cat Day, Cat Protection is launching a competition on its Facebook page.
Yeah.
You can post cat photos and stories on Facebook.com, Cat Protection.
Yeah.
And the owner with the most likes for his black cat receives a hamper of cat products and food.
Well, that's not much, is it?
Yeah?
That's not much of a
campaign.
Well,
they're trying to encourage people to take in black cats. But anyway, look...
Well, no, they're not. They're asking people to take pictures of the black cat they've already got, put it on Facebook and win some hampers.
I think it's sinister. Listen, did you read that...
Let me read you a few tweets out, because we haven't got... we haven't read enough of them out.
All right.
And I think I can award the tweet of the night to Julie.
Okay.
Who's actually texted it, so it can't be the tweet of the night. Mm. 81089 is the text number. She says, instead of turning chickens into dinosaurs, maybe that guy should try turning that dinosaur Parry into an enlightened human being.
Oh, that's very funny.
I think that's
and you think that's the tweet of the night?
I think it is. From Julie.
A brainless bit of chatter like that.
I think
that.
It's very clever. She's linked the
very
whole dinosaur clever. Conversation with
very
your dinosaur-like attitude.
She doesn't sound like a Cambridge graduate
Don't
to me.
Don't start attacking her just because she's been critical of you. Now, Bill says this.
Yes.
Shameless Porky proving he is the worst social climber in the Western Hemisphere.
Why is that?
And stop using those stupid Scottish accents. He's from Scotland, Bill.
Yeah.
I think he's talking about your Andrew Lloyd Webber anecdote.
Well, I'm only telling you the truth of, you know, my inter-social relationship. With people from different strata of society. That's
now,
all.
Here's one from Mike, who says the furore over tax credits is because it wasn't in the Tory manifesto and Cameron denied any cuts live on TV, then did a total U-turn. What a surprise. Yeah. A politician doing a total U-turn.
Hang on, politicians do that all the time. Haven't they thrown that back in detractors' faces and said, yeah, but hang on, didn't the Labour government say there would be no tuition fees or something?
Yeah, well, that was the Lib Dems, wasn't it?
The Lib Dems.
How about this one from Woodenhead? He says, one of those hideous games where people get massacred. Sounds like Mike Parry's war correspondent years.
What's that?
Well, when you said you were talking about what people do you know, after Sunday,
that's
Christmas
right. Yeah,
lunch.
They get on their old tablets and start playing weird games where people blow each other up.
Yeah, exactly right.
How mad is that?
And then some people are saying that they've found a picture of Dr. Horner.
Oh yes,
and he looks a bit like you. Look,
let's have a look.
There he is. He's out in the Montana wilderness.
Actually, he does have a slight resemblance
Dr.
to me.
Dr. Jack Horner.
Yeah, Montana's a big place, isn't it?
Very big place. Have you been there?
Yes, I've been there.
I went there, I think I told you, for the old Patrick Duffy's parents getting massacred.
I read, I'm sure this is right, that Ted Turner, the founder of CNN and the former husband of Jane Fonda, has a ranch in Montana which is the size of Wales.
Yeah, I think that's about right.
Is that right?
Yeah, I would say so.
Yeah. Because bearing in mind, I mean, to get people's perspective right, the size of America, Texas, for instance, is three times the size of the United Kingdom.
That's right.
Texas alone.
Yeah.
Texas is one of 50 states of America. Mm. So it's quite feasible. You can have a farm the size of Wales in Montana.
You could.
Yeah.
Absolutely right.
Yeah.
Here's one from Tony. He says, that last expert you had is crazy. I think he's watched Jurassic Park a few too many times.
So do I.
And then Masha says, Porky's not looking forward to eating a Kentucky fried dinosaur anytime soon.
Certainly not.
And Woodenhead says, if they bring dinosaurs back from birds, Porky will have to visit the Velociraptor enclosure instead of the duck pond. That could be a bit frightening, couldn't it?
Well, yeah, but I mean, this idea of bringing dinosaurs back.
Why isn't it a great idea?
Well, because you're wasting your time. We're put on this earth, a lot of us, to try and help contribute to society. You do not contribute to society by wasting your time getting up every morning and saying, I've got this plan to turn chickens into dinosaurs.
No.
I mean, that is so stupid.
No, it's not. It's all about the discovery of knowledge.
I nearly got abusive to Dr. Horner.
You were verbally abusive too.
I wasn't abusive. I just don't think that a grown man should waste his time and his energy by pretending he can turn chickens into dinosaurs, and then soft-minded people, you know, feeble-minded frailheads, then go around giving him money to try and prove that you can do it. It's stupid, well, it's unnecessary, and there are better things to spend your time doing in life.
It's the expansion of knowledge. And
it's not expansion of knowledge. That's just a dream gone mad.
Here's one from Patrick, right?
They're all crazies.
Patrick says, how rude of Porky to verbally assault that poor doctor.
I didn't verbally assault him. I just wanted to know, you know, where he was coming from, and he couldn't explain.
How about this from Geordie Jeff?
Yes.
Mike, what about the Porky Parrius dinosaur, defined as a thick-skinned lumbering creature which likes to stomp its feet to get its own way and has an extraordinary appetite for Battenberg cake and fish fingers?
That sounds like... do you know that? That sounds quite a useful animal to me. If there was one...
Porky Parrius.
Yeah, if there was one designed like that, at least it wouldn't harm anybody in the world, right?
Mind you, it says thick-skinned. You're thin-skinned, actually, aren't you?
No, I'm not thin-skinned at all. No, you sure it didn't say thick-headed, referring to you?
No, it's Porky Parrius dinosaur, thick-skinned. Yeah. You're the most thin-skinned person I know.
I don't take offence.
You hate it when people have a go at you.
Rubbish.
You get all funny about it.
No, that's not me. You got me confused with somebody
now,
else.
Now, coming up in the next hour...
Yeah?
Actually, Mr... whoever, this from... Oh, this will stun you.
Yeah,
Julie says, and she's texted it again...
Right.
Actually, Mr Parry, I am a Cambridge graduate.
Oh, is she?
So there you go.
She's had me on.
Why would you say that? Why would you not believe it?
She's a Cambridge... Oh, I'd like to know which subject she graduated in.
Oh, would you?
Because I bet I know more about it than she does.
Which subject did you graduate in? Town planning.
And urban estate management.
Yeah,
actually.
But you didn't, except you didn't graduate.
Urban estate management.
Urban estate management, but you didn't graduate.
Because I'm smarter than the average bear...
Did they have bears at that particular college?
I learnt enough in... 1 year that other people take 3 years to
learn. Is that right?
So I didn't.
Well, Julie,
need to
do
stay
tell us
years.
What you're a graduate in. I'm sorry to have to ask, but Mr. Yes. Parry, of course, doesn't believe that you, as a woman, could in any way be clever or academically qualified, or indeed have a decent job apart from a secretary.
I think clever women are brilliant.
Do you?
Yeah.
Never been out with any?
No. Not that I know of.
Very harsh.
Hey, listen, in the next hour, I'm going to tell you why Wolverhampton is the worst town in this country to live in.
Yeah.
And that's not my view.
Yeah.
That's an official survey.
Excellent.
Drive on Talk Sport, the UK's only sports-dedicated drive time with Sky Sports. The sharpest analysis on all the day's action.
To say I'm angry is an understatement.
Laser-guided comment and rapid reaction from a nation of sports fanatics.
I don't like listening to them, I'll turn off.
Drive home with Darren Goff and Adrian Durham, weekday afternoons from 4 on Talk Sport with Sky Sports, the home of the Barclays Premier League for the next 4 seasons.
Hosting a dinner party? Yes. At Asda, there's 6 for £25 on a great range of wines, including Campo Viejo Rioja and Blossom Hill White Grenache. Asda. Save money, live better. Selected stores, lines and availability. Individually £5 to £8, max 6 per customer, 18 or over only. Drink aware. Ends November 5th. Unavailable in Scotland. Make me feel best.
Do you have a child aged 2, 3 or 4? Flu can be serious for young children, but you can help them stay well this winter. All it takes to help protect your children from flu is one simple nasal spray that's free, fast and painless. Don't put it off. Take up the offer from your GP as soon as you can. NHS. We're here to help you stay well this winter.
The following offer applies to new Mercedes-Benz SUVs ordered between the 2nd and the 8th of November 2015. 3 years free servicing is based on three services over 36 months, no cash alternative. When you buy a brand new Mercedes-Benz SUV, your first 3 years of servicing are taken care of for free. So, while you're on your three camping trips, your dozens of takeaway pickups...
They forgot the poppadoms!
...or your hundreds of school runs...
Daddy, why is that cow climbing on his friend?
You can rest assured that your Mercedes-Benz SUV will be running like it's brand new. For no extra cost, visit our SUV event at your local retailer from the 2nd to the 8th of November. Unmissable offers from Mercedes-Benz.
If you had the heating on, you wouldn't leave the front door open, would you? And you'd close all the windows too, right? But if your loft isn't insulated, you may as well be leaving your roof open.
As part of a government initiative, British Gas is giving away insulation to millions of UK homes. You don't need to be a customer, and best of all, it's free. Don't miss out. Call 0800 141 3222 or search free insulation to see if your home could benefit. Conditions and geographical restrictions apply.
The BMW i3. It's not just an electric car. It's an electric car that drives like a BMW, Rentals from £299 per month. Discover more at bmw.co.uk/i3. £3,699 initial rental. 36-month hire agreement from BMW Financial Services. Subject to status and availability for new vehicles ordered before 31st of December 2015 and registered by 31st of March 2016. UK only, guarantees may be required. Mileage and other conditions apply when you return the vehicle.
Get a generous helping of the latest odds and tasty tips with Paddy's Punts. Every weekday afternoon from 4 on Drive with Durham and Goffey on Talk Sport with Paddy Power. You're welcome. With the form on the football.
What a game.
The going on the GGs.
And they're off.
The crack on the cricket.
Six.
And lashings of Paddy's famous generosity.
Ah, come on, gives a break to me a bit of crack, isn't it?
Get your tips while they're hot with Paddy's Punts. Weekday afternoons from 4 with Adrian Durham and Darren Goff on Talk Sport with Paddy Power. You're welcome.
Talk Sport, we are the two mics, and of course there will be a podcast coming out a little bit later on. Here's one from Ian, who says, Porky's band of the day, the frail-minded feebleheads, which is not bad. Rodney from Hayes says, MG, I normally agree with you, but not on this. The mad scientist should be investigated by the FBI and the CIA and locked up quick. I mean, what sort of a world are we living in where you want to lock up people who are doing interesting, you know, scientific research?
Mad thing. Stephen's got a good one here. He says, can anyone find out what happened to the man who went missing in Anfield? Was he looking for a win?
Yeah, that's a bit harsh, isn't it? Very harsh.
Stephen also gets,
I don't know, it's a very strange story, though. They say it's been resolved now, so I'm glad whatever the problem was has been resolved, but I have no idea what it could be.
How could you go missing inside a football stadium?
Is it possible somebody might have just sort of wandered off and you know, how you can get lost? I mean, I don't wish to bring it up, but you remember that time you got locked in at the Newcastle Theatre?
Yes, I do, yes.
I mean, you could, in a football stadium, maybe do something similarly, wander into an area where you shouldn't have gone.
Not in broad daylight.
And find yourself behind a fire door and you couldn't get back or something. No?
It'd be unusual if you did.
I mean, I've never done really that many stadium tours, so, I mean, maybe you could tell me what that's like.
I tell you what, I was at the Emirates last week, and I exited the Emirates down through the players' car park, you know, where you see some of the most exotic cars in the world. I mean, really incredible.
Yeah. I saw an amazing BMW, actually, when I was driving back from Dorset the other day.
What colour was it?
It was sort of two-tone. It was blue and silver, and it's new kind of sports car they've got, which looks
Sounds very brilliant. Which looks very
flash indeed. Yeah.
But getting out of the Emirates, you're absolutely right. I mean, you're in a labyrinth of... what happens is when the visiting team comes now, in the old days, yours used to stand around the players' entrance, wait until the coach pulled up, and then, you know, maybe they'd put a couple of little iron railings up, and that would give the players a passageway into the dressing
room.
But now, certainly the Emirates and certainly at Wembley and all, you know, new stadiums built from now on, the coaches go underground.
Yeah.
And so the fans never get to see the players anymore, you know, which is a bit of a shame, I think.
But, I mean, when I was at Chelsea, when I took my son to Chelsea, they bring them in a coach.
Yeah.
And you can stand around where as they get off the coach,
sure.
So you can see them there.
But again, the players' cars at Chelsea go into an underground car park, but there's a special ramp where they come up, and that's where all the fans stand.
Yeah.
And that's where, if the players have had a good game and they're feeling in the mood, they drive
up. That hasn't happened for a while.
No, it hasn't happened for a while. They bring the window down and start signing autographs and things. Now then, what I was going to say to you was, old Stephen, who said, you know, were they looking for a win?
Yeah.
It gets a bit political here. I support Jeremy Corbyn for Prime Minister. I don't always agree with your politics, and this is directed to me.
Yeah.
But it's democracy and opinions are welcome. So there
Why
you go.
Why is it directed to you?
Well, because he sent it to me, you see. Yeah.
Who else did he send it to?
I don't know.
Well, what does it say? At who?
It says at the two mics at Mike Parry 8.
So he's directed at both of us?
Well, not really, because I'm part of the two mics, and I am Mike
Parry 8. At the two mics. You see, this is part of your delusional qualities.
What's that then?
You think that anything sent to the two mics is actually sent to you?
Well, I do think that I have a sort of dominant kind of presence.
Is that right? Well, only because you talk more.
No, I don't think
Here's
so.
Here's one from Roy, who's directed it at the two mics. I don't know whether you would think that's directed at you or me.
Yes.
Or possibly both. He says, you're not attacking multinational corporations who are avoiding taxes. Sound like a couple of bladdered Tories.
Really?
Hashtag join the Lords. Well, Roy, I mean, I've never been particularly in favour of the House of Lords. I'm also not particularly in favour of hammering multinational corporations who pay an awful lot of people an awful lot of money, who pay an awful lot of income tax in whatever country they work in. And if they choose to hire accountants to avoid paying, you know, punitive rates of corporation tax, then they're perfectly entitled to do so.
Yeah,
thank you very much.
And they do employ thousands of people around the world. Now then, Porky
always...
Yeah,
they all pay income tax.
Yes, that's right.
That's the bit that nobody ever says.
Yeah, Porky always says it and he gets more embarrassing every time. Why do you call these professionals doc? Well, because the title's doctor, so doc is a shortage of it, you know. And prof, there's nothing wrong with that. Now then...
How about this one from Adam in Leicester? He says, "Hi, Mike. Porky likes to look down on those who don't drive a BMW or aren't earning fortunes, but that's not real life. My wife and I were made redundant from the same firm at the same time just when we realised my wife was pregnant. I had to get what work I could to keep a roof over our heads, and my earnings nosedived. It's fair to say I'd love a BMW, but sometimes you just have to carry on when you get dealt a bad hand."
Yeah, well, that sounds like a very touching story, mate, and good luck to you for, you know, getting out of bed in the mornings and going finding work. It is a horrible position to be in, and I have sympathy with you. I hope you've resolved the... what are you laughing at?
Said with as much sincerity as you can muster.
I do. I hope you've resolved the position to your satisfaction.
Yeah.
Right, one here says, "Now then, Mr. Parry, the last expert you had is crazy," and he puts "expert" in inverted commas.
Yeah.
"I think he's watched Jurassic Park a few too many times." See, a lot of people thought he was off his rocker, that guy.
No, not at all.
So I wasn't the only one who treated him with skepticism.
Now, tell us about this survey you found about Wolverhampton.
Yeah, now, this is interesting, right? Wolverhampton is as glum as its most famous son, a report I found the other day says. Yeah. But it says that its most famous son is 1D Liam Payne.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that the most famous person that's ever come out of Wolverhampton?
Well, that's what it says
here. Can you think of anybody else? I'll see if I can find anybody else.
Pongo Waring.
Who?
Pongo Waring.
Who's that?
He played centre-forward for Aston Villa before the Second World War.
Well, funnily enough, I've never heard of him.
And,
why would I have heard of a guy
and
who
he was a backcountry boy?
Before the Second World War.
Well, he was. My dad told me about him. Now, the other...
Noddy Holder from Wolverhampton.
Noddy Holder, yeah, he's from Wolverhampton, yeah. Now, the other guy is... Do you remember Enoch Powell?
I do remember Enoch Powell.
And Enoch Powell, I don't think, was from Wolverhampton, but his parliamentary seat was Wolverhampton North, I think.
I think you might be right.
And his... He always used to say that whenever, you know, politics became too muddled for him or he was under pressure or he needed a breath of fresh air, he used to go walking up this hill near to where he lived in Wolverhampton and then look over what he called the Black Country.
Right.
It's called the Black Country because, of course, it was in the cradle of industrial development in the 18th and 19th centuries.
Yeah.
All you could see for miles were factories and chimneys and smoke.
Smokestacks.
That's right, smokestacks, yeah.
I have to say I'm doing a bit of looking up here. I don't see many people from Wolverhampton.
Right.
Slade did come from there. Mm. Corner Shop came from there.
Mm.
Beverly Knight, Goldie, and the Roots reggae maestro, who I'm sure you would have heard of,
yes,
called Macca B.
Macca B. No,
it's
not familiar to me.
No.
Now, Wolverhampton South West MP Rob Maris hits back. He says Wolverhampton has got some of the cheapest housing. Well, that usually is an indication of an area which is not perhaps that prosperous.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
More trees per head than almost anywhere else in the UK.
Mm.
Do we believe that?
More what?
More trees per head than,
really?
Than almost anywhere
else in the
UK. Well,
that could mean there's just not that many people living there.
Yeah, it could be.
You know, and you can read these things two ways.
And a growing economy and decent schools. Now, it says amongst the other spots which are not good places to live, Sandwell, Blackpool, East Derbyshire are rated next most unhappy spots by researchers.
Oh, yeah.
And London boroughs, Hammersmith and Fulham in Kensington and Chelsea are top for prosperity. Well, that's not surprising, because the average price of a house there is £1 million.
Well, it sounds to me they're basing all of this on money again, aren't
they? Yeah, I think they are, and not the quality of life.
Mm.
I mean, for instance, they mentioned Sandwell. Now, when I worked on the Birmingham Evening Mail, where I rose to a very senior position...
What position was that?
Assistant editor.
Assistant editor?
Yes.
Oh, look how he says it.
Yes.
Assistant editor. How many of those were there? Probably about 10, right?
No, not many, not many. But what we had to do
more
is...
More than one, anyway.
We had to attack the Wolverhampton Express and Star.
Yeah.
Because they had such a dominant hold on the Black Country, actually, based on Dudley.
Yeah.
And, of course, Wolverhampton. And so we decided to move it on their territory, which I thought was mad, because they had a circulation there of about 380,000,
right,
and we had a circulation of about 3, literally,
because
we had a huge circulation in Birmingham. Mm. We had the same number of papers in Birmingham.
Yeah.
We didn't expect Wolverhampton to come over to Birmingham. I don't know why we know it. Anyway, point of the story is we opened the Sandwell Evening Mail, which was like a Black Country
paper. Is this Sandwell as in one of the other terrible places to live?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
So two very close together.
Two very close together, indeed.
It's not good, is it?
And it was just a waste of time, waste of money. We put on a circulation of about another 200 a day or something like that. You know,
shocking. A bit of a failure for you then.
It was a failure.
Some people are saying Robert Plant's from Wolverhampton, but he's not. He's from West Bromwich.
I thought he was from... Yeah, he is from West Bromwich.
He was born in West Bromwich.
He now lives in Kidderminster.
Yeah.
A lot of the Led Zeppelin guys lived on farms like Stourbridge in Kidderminster way.
Right.
Out that way, you know.
Now, how about this from Ross? He says, "I'm from Wolverhampton and I bought 7 tickets to the Birmingham show, so tread carefully when abusing the place."
Oh, no, we're not abusing the place at all. In fact, I'm sticking up for it and saying that I think it's rather a lovely town, Wolverhampton. Yeah. And I'll tell you how I know that. because when I
Why
used
are you
to make
that noise,
because I was thinking, that's my thinking noise.
Is that your thinking noise? When you don't hear it very often.
Sometimes when I was driving north to south, so if I was coming down from Chester, you know, in the days when my family was still there, and I was going back to London or something like that, or even maybe back to Birmingham where I worked on the Evening Mail, I'd avoid the motorway altogether because you had to go like 25 miles out of Chester to get to the M6. You see what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So I'd just go down the A41, and that would go through places like Newport, Woodchurch. And eventually...
That's quite a decent road, the A40.
Yeah, it's all right, yeah. Yeah, and eventually down to Wolverhampton itself.
Yeah.
And quite often I would, you know, have a mate who'd be in Wolverhampton, I'd stop there and we'd go for a few pints there. So I've never had a problem with Wolverhampton.
Yeah.
Always found it rather
architecturally you could do the same today.
Attractive.
As Ben says, excuse me, Mr. Parry, Wolverhampton is lovely. Weatherspoons are everywhere and we've been eating off wood around here for years.
Excellent. That's what I like to hear.
So there you go.
Good news.
Lots more from Wolverhampton coming up. And also Ask Porky, not very far away. This is Talk Sport.
Don't phone your mother. Phone Talk Sport.
Football. Football. Football on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
Athletico Radio.
Talk Sport.
Every day when I'm away, I'm thinking of you. Everyone can carry on except for we two. And you know that I love, and you know.
Now, that's a song you don't hear very often.
Yeah, it's a Slade song,
it
isn't
it? It is a Slade song, yeah.
Yeah, but it's not the most popular Slade song,
is
it? I know,
but I like it, actually.
Yeah, I like
it
as well.
Some of the ones that I haven't heard for a long time. Now, they're very competitive up there in the Midlands, aren't
they? Right, go on.
Duncan in Leicester, who says he's originally from Walsall, says, Noddy Holder came from Walsall, you pair of planks.
Yeah, OK, well, that's not Wolverhampton, is it?
Well, lots of people seem to think he came from Wolverhampton.
Well, I thought he came from Wolverhampton. I worked in Walsall once as well, on the same project I've just told you about, trying to make the Black Country a Birmingham
Here's one from Mark in Stourbridge, who says he works in Wolverhampton. He says, Wolverhampton is great. Fireworks 365 days of the year. Mm. Well, that's how the drug lords tell the natives the drugs have arrived. Worst kept secret in Wolves.
It's rather a deep one, though, isn't it?
Yeah. Saying
I tell you what I was going to say about that that song there. That was Noddy Holder. Now, of course, Christmas is coming, right? And we'll be talking about it, you know, in weeks to come and all that kind of stuff.
We will.
But every year, Noddy Holder, who co-wrote the song, you know, Happy Christmas, what's it called?
It's called...
Here we go, Merry Christmas, everybody's having fun.
It's Merry Christmas, everybody, isn't it?
Merry Christmas, everybody, yeah. Apparently...
So here it is, Merry Christmas.
So here it is, Merry Christmas,
yeah. Not Here We Go.
Which I think famously everybody knows was recorded in a studio in New York in 88 degrees of temperature in the summer.
Yes.
And, you know, that's how far ahead you have to plan for Christmas, as we're finding out on some projects.
Well, Mickey Brennan, funnily enough, our old friend who now lives in Costa Rica, was sent down, I think it was at the... I can't remember the name of the studios now, the record plant or something like that.
Yeah.
Maybe that's wrong, I think that's in LA. But one of the big studios in New York, and he went in to take pictures of Slade.
Oh, really?
And he'd been asked to get them all dressed up as Father Christmas and all that. And because it was, in a strange time of the year.
Yeah, very hard to find the clothes, I suppose. Yeah.
And apparently he said this bearded guy came wandering through and said, hey, you know, to talk to the Slade guys. He said, hey, you guys, you know, don't let this guy mess you around. Don't dress up like an idiot. You know, we're musicians. We shouldn't be playing all these ridiculous parts.
Yeah.
You know, don't be doing that. And Mickey told him to F off, basically.
Yes.
He told this guy to get out.
Yeah.
Turned out it was Jerry Garcia from The Grateful Dead.
Was it? Really? Yeah. And he didn't recognise him.
Didn't recognise him, didn't know who he was.
Imagine, that man ingested so many substances, his face had probably changed, eh?
Very possibly so.
But now, what I was going to say before you go on, what I was going to say about Noddy Holder is, every year about this time, somebody comes along and buys the rights to Merry Christmas, Everybody's Having Fun.
Really?
Which then is used in some advertising campaign over Christmas.
Well, wasn't it last...
And he gets like, I mean, you know, I stand to be corrected here, but between quarter and half a million for that advertising campaign.
Well, I mean, I think he's right, I'm right saying he's one of the, it's one of the most sort of well paid up songs every single year.
Absolutely.
Because it's used every single year.
Absolutely,
every year
it gets
put on another album, another sort it's a bit like the Wizard one as well, isn't it?
That's right,
It could be Christmas every day.
It could be Christmas every day.
Now, how about this? Mr. Clark says, I have this image in my head of Porky and Andrew Lloyd Webber sitting in the back of a limousine with chihuahuas in their lap.
Chihuahuas?
Yeah. Well, we were talking to the guy about inventing, you know, having chihuahuas.
Yeah.
Nathan says, if this were 200 years ago, I suspect Porky would have the doctor burnt at the stake, regressive view for mankind.
Well, no, but I wouldn't allow him to spread such, you know, outrageous scientific theories, because it does all sound a bit crazy, doesn't it? I mean, it really does.
Well, I find it quite interesting. Now, how about this one from Mark? He says, my wife and six-year-old son got locked in Anfield last year. The tour guide was frantic, thought she was getting the sack.
Really?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That.
Really? Isn't that strange?
Yeah. I tell you where I've been at Anfield, actually, and not through choice. It was because, you know, it was part of a job I was doing at the time, interviewing somebody.
Yeah.
I had to go to the museum, which is a separate sort of annex to Anfield.
Right.
And it's very impressive.
Is it outside of the stadium gates, you mean?
Yes, outside of the stadium gates, as far as I can recall.
Right.
And it is very impressive because it has five replicas of their...
European Cups.
European Cups, that's right, yeah. Right. And, you know, all the other trophies, the one over the years and the Bill Shankly Monument and all that kind of stuff. It is very impressive.
Mm.
But I can see, I suppose, if, you know, if you lock that up and went home for the night or something like that, that there might be a problem there. But, I mean, it's still very odd, isn't it? Very odd indeed.
Very strange story.
Now then, did you know, talking about Christmas coming up and all that, and obviously there'll be an excess of bladderation around, did you know that there's a movement starting amongst our lawmakers to reverse what they say are now 24-hour drinking laws, back to the laws you and I had to abide to when we were youngsters.
You know, Sunday 12 till 2, 7 till 10, that kind of thing.
And daytimes...
I don't think society could handle it now.
Daytimes, 10:30 in the morning till 2:30 or 3 o'clock.
Yeah.
Not opening again till 5 o'clock in the evening until 10:30 or 11 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
And scrap 24-hour drinking. How do you think that would go down?
I don't think most people now who have been so used to being able to drink whatever they want will be able to handle it.
I totally agree with you. And by the way, although I was against it when it was first introduced because I foresaw, crisis on the streets, which is what we've got, by the way.
Yeah.
Because the police do say, you speak to them, they say, look, you know, everybody moans that we're not patrolling the streets anymore and that we're slow to respond to burglaries. What do you expect?
Yeah.
At weekends, on the Thursday, Friday, Saturday and sometimes Sunday, 80% of our resources are dealing with drunks in town centres.
Yeah.
Or stopping drunks from making trouble in town centres.
And all the people that run pubs will tell you that, you know, the people who are getting that drunk and getting into trouble are actually drinking before they come out.
That's right.
So, I mean, maybe what you would have is just an epidemic of people sitting around at home and drinking. I don't know.
I'm sure you would. But, I mean, do you remember those days when the pub, literally, there's a bell rang at 2:30?
Yeah.
Last orders, or 2:25, last orders, you're getting your last order, and then you were thrown out.
Well, I remember days when you'd be driving around, when my older kids were very young, and you'd drive around and go, right, we'll go out for a pub lunch somewhere.
Yes.
And you'd desperately be racing against the clock get somewhere, because it would say you got stuck in traffic.
Yes.
And it's 1:30.
Yes, that's
And you know, if you get there, sort of, in some pubs, if you got there at 10 to 2...
Yeah.
They'd go, oh,
the kitchen's closed.
No, it's all, you know. And then you'd say, well, why? And it's almost 2 o'clock.
Well, when I worked in Chester, in the Chester Chronicle there, and Chester's a beautiful city, we had an arrangement with all the landlords because we worked on the paper.
Yeah.
You always did, didn't you?
An arrangement?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well, like lock-ins.
Like a lock-in?
An all-day lock-in,
so you could just go there whenever you liked?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know, it was literally...
Certainly Fleet Street pubs were like that.
Yeah, do you know what the knock was?
It was...
That was a knock on the door.
It's not
very
inventive.
No, but it was the one we used to use.
Right.
Meant that was the secret code to. What are you laughing at? Huh?
What if they didn't hear the start of it because they were in another room?
Shall we do it again?
Yeah, go on.
That was a secret code to get into the Victoria pub on the cross in Chester,
Okay.
And you could...
was there somebody standing behind the door listening to this?
No.
What if they only heard the end of it? They might have thought, somebody doesn't know the whole code.
No. They would hear it. No, they used to all live above the pub and all that kind of stuff, you know, so that wasn't a problem.
Right.
There was always somebody in there from the paper anyway, because you used to do it.
They make you just drink and then pay later, or did they break the law and actually take the money off you?
Didn't matter. Sometimes on the slate, sometimes you paid after 5 o'clock when they could legally open again.
Yeah.
But there was always somebody in there from the paper anyway. We used to drink in shifts.
Mm.
You know, there were certain people who had certain jobs. Remember, it was a weekly newspaper, so a lot of the people who were called sub-editors...
Was there a rota for this?
There was a rota, to get down the boozer, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And one guy, I remember, his name was Peter Tromans.
Right.
He was the night editor.
You never give his name out.
No, he's a good lad, Pete. That's right, yeah. And he was... he's a good lad, and I'm not sure what the equivalent of a night editor is on a weekly newspaper, but he's like production editor, I suppose. He's a production editor, right. And you know, he's a great guy and he's very hospitable, big drinker, drunk pints of lager all the time. And he saw an advert in the UK Press Gazette for a production editor at the Stafford Newsletter, which was much closer to his home.
Right.
He was a Black Country boy, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
And so he fancied going back. But one stipulation for the job was, you know, he made absolutely sure there was more daily drinking time in Stafford than there was in Chester. Right. Because he said he needed it to relax.
Well, to be the night editor of a weekly paper is not particularly stressful,
no,
is it?
It's not really, no. Considering the paper comes out once a week. Yeah. That's right, yeah.
Unbelievable.
But I totally agree with you. I'm not sure we could go back now to the archaic sort of
it would seem like a massive step backwards. And I think, I mean, most people are now used to going out and, like, for example, for me, if I go out and meet somebody for a drink in the afternoon during the week, it's much more kind of better. It's better for me to do it at, say, 3 or 4 than it is to do it at 1 o'clock.
I totally agree. And it's not known for you and I to, you know, sometimes when we work here till 6 a.m. to go off and have breakfast in a pub where we'll have a few pints between 6 and 9.
Last week, in fact, when I went and had a drink with my daughter and we walked into this wine bar at 4 o'clock, the place was deserted. There was nobody there. 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yeah, that's right.
And it started filling up after 5 because people had stopped working.
It does, yeah.
But it's quite nice to go somewhere where there's nobody around.
I totally agree. It's very relaxing, isn't it? Rather than the rush to get in a pub at 11
and
o'clock.
And also that rush to get last orders.
Yeah,
it's horrendous.
To be out again at 2:30. No, I totally agree. Yeah. Totally agree.
I don't miss that at all. I don't want them to bring it back. This is Talk Sport. We've got Ask Porky coming up next.
Yeah.
UEFA Champions League football live on Talk Sport. Get set for another season of exhilarating European football action.
Come on!
Featuring full match commentaries of all the Premier League teams in action and updates and goal flashes as they hit the back of the net.
Champions of Europe again.
Plus full-on post-match phone-ins following all the action. UEFA Champions League football live on Talk Sport with Direct Line. For 5-star rated van insurance, search Direct Line Van.
This is the unique go-kart feeling of a turbocharged Mini Cooper 3-door hatch. And this is how it feels knowing that you got it for just £189 a month plus initial rental. Book a test drive at your nearest Mini Centre or mini.co.uk/turbo. 48-month hire agreement from Mini Financial Services. £2,399 initial rental. Subject to status. Guarantees may be required. Available for new vehicles ordered by 31st of December and registered by 31st of March. Participating retailers only. Mileage and other conditions apply when you return the vehicle. Visit mini.co.uk/turbo.
Left a bit. Right a bit. Little bit more to the right.
Ah, the Fusspots. We like you. Because you're not happy until everything is just right. And at Wix, nor are we. That's why we have a stylish range of tiling and flooring to suit all tastes. And right now, there's up to half price off all styles. So you can get everything 100% right. Wix. Let's do it right.
Clever, ambitious, hardworking. Just some of the qualities of the accountancy professionals at Barnes Rove. And due to expansion, our forward-thinking firm has some fantastic career opportunities in Greater London for the right people. Our training and support are second to none because our clients expect the best. So if you're an audit manager, audit senior, or high-achieving graduate, visit barnesrove.com. Barnes Rove. Clever accountants for business.
How can apprenticeships help grow your business? I'm here with Shelley Thompson, training manager at Angels the Costumiers, to find out.
Having apprentices is a win-win situation. It gives us young, enthusiastic talent and it gives them an entry point into a very difficult industry. Having apprentices does meet the need of our business because it gives us a pool of very well-trained staff who are ready when we need them.
Thousands of companies like Angels are realising the value of apprenticeships. With a free recruitment service and the possibility of a grant of at least £1,200, there's never been a better time to hire an apprentice. Find out more at greatbusiness.gov.uk/apprenticeships.
The last report filled in, the hospital speaks. The murmur of big voices and noisy little ones. A long day on maternity, but a great day. The squeak of my shoes heading home. Good morning. And good night, nurse, they say. I say, hello, tasty dinner.
We don't all work 9 to 5. Some of us work 5 to 9. That's why you can find delicious M&S food at your local BP 24/7. BP. Green lights all the way. Selected stations only.
Enjoy Bags of Banter every Friday afternoon from 1 on the Fools panel with Hawksby and Jacobs on Talk Sport. With Burton's Fish and Chips. It's the full flavour weekly feature for live debate, celebrity sports predictions, and bags of tasty topical chip chat. The Fools panel, a satisfying portion of great British fun. Every Friday afternoon from 1 with Hawksby and Jacobs on Talk Sport with Burton's Fish and Chips. Kicks hunger.
A little bit later on, the Porky quiz coming up on Thursday on Isambard Kingdom Brunel. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow it's Porky Vision, which we're all very much looking forward to as well. Lots of Ask Porkies to get through here.
Right.
So,
as per
usual, we've had a great variety of them.
I want to help people change their lives.
I know you do. Yeah. And I would like you to do, as ever, answer as succinctly as you can, but as well as you can, and we shall move through them very quickly. Mm. Here's one from Tom. It says, the Baseball World Series is about to start. Who does Mike Parry, with his love of US sport, think will win, the Mets or the Royals?
Well, I think the Mets will probably win it. But then again, you know, I've got a lot to concentrate on in Europe and in this country when it comes to sport. And I don't waste too much of my time looking across the pond at sport in America. The only people who do, and you see these people tweeting out all the time about, oh, you know, this team's done well, this team's done well. And American are really, they're just people who want you to think that they are, you know, internationally aware of sport all around the world, but particularly they've got a finger on the pulse of American sport. It makes them feel trendy, makes them feel super knowledgeable, makes them feel that you will admire them because they can interpret what's going on in American football.
This is quite a long answer, this.
Even though in this country hardly anybody could care less about American sport.
All right, so you think the Mets will win, in other words?
Mets.
Thank you very much indeed. One from Paul. Shall I take my girlfriend to Barcelona for the weekend or buy tickets for the Rugby World Cup final with the lads?
Well, that's a choice. It's not a choice of Barcelona or the rugby. It's a choice of whether you want to spend time with your dearly beloved, your girlfriend, or you want to have a stag weekend with the lads. If I were you, I'd go with your girlfriend, OK? I think you'd get a more rewarding few hours, few days, whatever it's going to be, in Barcelona with your girlfriend than actually getting bladderated and doing what you do every weekend with the boys back home here for a rugby match which does not involve your own country and therefore to which you have no allegiance.
Why not take his girlfriend to the rugby?
Well, that's a waste of time.
Why?
Well, because you're trying to then mix two persuasions. Right. One is a love for sport, the other is a love for your girlfriend. It don't work.
Yeah, interesting. Now, here's one from Michael. Oh, no, sorry, it's not from Michael. It's Simon.
Yes.
He says, I potentially have the chance to live and work in Turkey for a year in the current climate. What would Porky do?
I would not go. Turkey's very hot. And you don't want to be overheated. And also, the problem I find with Turkey is that getting across the Bosphorus is often very, very difficult in heavy traffic, and therefore getting from the Blue Mosque to the western side can be a problem. Don't go.
So that's a pretty good, strong recommendation. This is an interesting one from Scott in Grimsby,
yes,
who's actually texted this one in. I've been recently watching Dexter, he says, an American series about a serial killer who kills bad men.
Right.
If you could have killed an enemy and got away with it, would you?
No, I will not take a life. Can't take a human life. If I did, I'd fear damnation. And I fear that when I got to the pearly gates, St. Peter would not let me in because I'd taken another human being's life. Having said
so
that...
So you believe in the pearly gates then?
Oh, yes, definitely. So having said that, I do believe that there is a view within the godliness of the heavens that very evil people should be deprived of their life on earth because they harm others.
OK.
Yes.
So you wouldn't do it anyway.
No.
Here's one from somebody calling himself Man City Army. My mate's wife recently left him. How long should I wait before I make a move on her?
I wouldn't wait. I'd make it instant. Because you've got to remember that there are no rules in love or war. And if you don't make a move on your mate's ex-wife, somebody else will. And if she's a real cracker, that will happen sooner rather than later. So don't hesitate. What was the Rod Stewart song? You know, don't hesitate, don't be too late. Yes, that's it.
Don't hesitate, don't be too late. Now, here's an interesting scientific question, actually, or perhaps philosophical, from Vaughan. Was Schrodinger's cat dead or alive? His vet rang, as you might remember, and said, I've got good and bad news.
Sorry, what was the start?
Schrodinger's cat. You know, this is the cat that they put into this. It was a way of explaining, like, quantum physics. They put this cat into a box.
Did they?
In an imaginary box.
Right.
And they basically put it in with some poison and some uranium.
Yeah, did it die?
Well, the question is the cat dead before the uranium and the poison poisons it? Is the cat only dead when you open the box to discover that it's dead? It's one of those.
Hang on, this is like if the tree fell over and there was nobody there, would it make any noise?
Exactly.
Yeah, it's a load of nonsense. I'm not answering that question. It's drivel.
You're not answering Schrodinger's cat?
No.
OK, here's the next one then. Will you ever do an autobiography and would you let Mr. Graham ghostwrite it? That's not from me, by the way.
No, I know, yeah. Maybe one of these days, but I can only do that when I feel I'm reaching the end, and I haven't even reached halfway yet, so the answer is not in the foreseeable future. And as for getting Mike to write it, why would I want some half-baked moron to write it when I could do it myself?
Here's one from Murphy. It says, after buying my first house, I have a few quid lying around. Should I get a couple of buy-to-let places and become a slum landlord?
Well, you don't become a slum landlord by buying a couple of buy-to-let places. If you want to invest in property, which is a very, very good investment because it does have occasional dips in its value progression, but mostly speaking, it's been going up now for the last 100 years, it's a very good investment. So I would say yes. But do remember that you're not becoming a slum landlord. You want to keep a high standard of care for your property so that people rent them for a fair rent. But you don't just buy property, put somebody in it, and then walk away. It is a very time consuming business looking after property. Property requires permanent, and I mean permanent, renovation and restoration.
Here's one from Kevin. He says, who does Porky think is the best man to replace his old mate Steve Sherwood at the Villa, and would he take the job if offered?
I wouldn't want to make a gamble on that because I think Villa are going down. So I think any manager who comes is going to be in charge of a relegation team. I've already tried to indicate that I think David Moyes is too clever a man to take that job and snatching, you know, what he sees as a short-term return to the Premier League, because it would be short-term. Villa are going down. I think the answer to the Villa situation is go and find a great manager in the Championship and give him the opportunity to do it with Villa. Probably won't save them, but then may get them back into the Premier League.
Here's one from Kelly. He says, it's nearly celebrity jungle time. Would Porky go in with the rest of the Z-rated celebs?
It would depend how much they offered me to do it.
So it's a financial thing?
Absolutely financial.
It's kind of Daniel Craig in the next James Bond.
Yes,
then.
That's right, yeah. I mean, the thought of putting all those horrible things in your mouth and
I
all
don't
that.
I think you'd like that.
I would hate it, but if the money was sufficiently attractive, I would do it. I'm a mercenary when it comes to work projects like that.
Here's one from Rosie. Mr. Parry, how might I discourage seagulls from nesting on my house and making a mess on my murk?
They shouldn't be making a mess on your murk. It's very difficult to stop birds landing on the rooftops of homes.
I think it's actually illegal to interfere with seagulls' nests. I think they're protected.
Oh, they are, yeah, but they don't usually nest on your house. They usually nest somewhere else, but they do visit your house and that kind of stuff.
No, they do. I mean, when I first moved down to Hastings, they were nesting on the roofs of the street.
Really?
And it was a terrible noise.
Oh, well, I've never seen that. I don't live that close to the sea in Stockbroker Weald, Surrey. However, I live right on the edge of Portsmouth Harbour, and we don't have seagulls nesting there. That's probably because they've got better places to nest, like the rushes and all that kind of stuff. The answer is put lots of spikes around so they can't land.
Okay. How about this one? If you could ask Mike Graham any question, this is from Ian, what would it be?
Well, it wouldn't be, because as we've known each other so long, there's very few questions we haven't asked each other over the years. So, to be perfectly honest, there isn't a question in the world that I haven't asked him already.
OK. Carl says, Porky, my wife has treated me to tickets for the Birmingham show.
Yes.
I've booked a hotel. Am I right to expect Rogerisation?
Well, that's entirely depends on relationship with... Did you say it was his wife?
His wife, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's a bit intimate to ask that in public, because that's something that's private between you and your wife. If you'd have said to me, oh, I've just pulled a new girlfriend or something, then I'd have said, yeah, get stuck in, my boy. But I will not make any such...
Oh, what? Have you got some kind of old-fashioned thing about wives?
Well, not really.
It doesn't stop you having affairs with
them. No. But I think it's rather intimate and personal to start commenting on a man's physical relationship with his wife. I just hope you have a great weekend, a great time, and behave as the two of you wish to and require to, and enjoy our show.
Now, Jennifer says this.
Yes.
Does Porky think it's strange that hardly anybody liked the House of Lords earlier this week, and now somehow they're the best thing since sliced bread?
Well, I don't quite get it myself. I mean, I get bored with politics, to be perfectly honest, and don't really get involved these days. But the idea that, you know, a group of unelected guys who put the ermine on. And, yeah, it's full of people like Neil Kinnock, who years ago called them brigands.
And Andrew Lloyd Webber.
And Andrew Lloyd Webber. And you know, I'm on both sides, Tories, Lib Dems, Labour. You know, mostly over the years, these politicians have slagged off the House of Lords and said they were unrepresentative. And then, of course, they take the ermine because they get like 400 quid a day or something, isn't it, for just being a member of the House of Lords?
No, we haven't got a lot of time, so we're going to rush through a couple of last-minute ones. Here's one from David. With American NFL taking over our national stadium next year, should we also lease out Big Ben?
Well, I'm not in favour of Wembley being the home of an American sport, which is followed by so few people in this country. I personally would like to see it withdrawn, but that depends on the finances of Wembley. But I think it's really ridiculous to talk about taking England football games out of Wembley and putting American football games into Wembley. Nonsense.
But it has happened. Finally, this one from Greer, who says, as one simple question, will you sing Donald, Where's Your Trousers at the Garage on December the 5th? It would be a memory to cherish.
Definitely not.
Are you sure?
No, I think I'd get booed off stage, but I do think it's a great song. Donald, Where's Your Trousers? I just come down from the Isle of Skye. But I won't be singing that on the night of our concert in Glasgow, December the 5th, Saturday.
Uh-huh. OK.
At the Garage.
Well, I'm going to encourage you to do it.
In Sucky Hull Street.
I'm going to encourage you to do it. We'll just have to get you bladdered in order to affect it happening, maybe the second half of the show.
It can happen.
It can happen. We've got lots more coming up. That was Ask Porky for another session. Don't forget, it's Porky Vision tomorrow night and the Porky Quiz on Isambard Kingdom Brunel on Thursday night. This is TalkSport.
On DAB, digital radio, and 1089 and 1053 AM.
A terrific performance.
Turn of pace and eye for goal.
Shout about it.
Talk sport.
Talk Sport, we are the two mics. There will, of course, be a podcast coming out in the very near future, in about 5 hours from now, to be precise. We've got still lots of tweets and texts to read out, and thank you for everybody for sending in your Ask Porky questions. We get so many now that we can't obviously do them all, but anything that you would like to have read out, you can stand a very good chance of sending it in and getting it read out next Tuesday, of course. David says, did Porky mean Baby, I Love Your Way by Peter Frampton? Were you singing that song when you were singing the song? I'm not sure.
No, I've never heard of that song.
You haven't heard Baby, I Love Your Way by Peter Frampton?
No.
Well, I'm sure if we played it, you'd recognise
it.
Well,
I probably would, yeah.
Davey says, I'm on both sides, Tory, Lib Dem and Labour. Ha ha, quote of the night so far from Porky.
Mm-hmm.
Ray says, St Peter wouldn't let Porky in anyway because he's a plank.
Oh, that's very nice. Thank you very much indeed.
David says, for a late one, we pretend to be print workers and have a drink at a place near Gough Square.
Which is when we're talking about
pubs that were open late.
Well, there was a late drinking...
The first tweet he says, when the pubs used to shut in the afternoon, it was time to visit the members' clubs behind Oxford Street.
Yeah.
Great days.
Yeah, Oxford Street, yeah. But what we did in Fleet Street, of course, is we invented a golf club. We called it the City Golf Club.
That's right, yeah.
And it was down that little
alleyway. It was around the back of St Bride's, wasn't it?
Right. Yeah, that's right, yeah. Near to St Bride's, just off Fleet Street.
And did they not put in one of those screens where you could hit the golf ball into it?
Yeah, exactly,
just to make it like more authentic.
It was a simulated golf tee.
Yeah.
And we got, we got like standing of a golf club and
it was membership, right?
Member hours,
Which and meant you, could just stand
and
there
you used
time.
To go down these very steep stairs. And
yeah.
It was quite daunting going in there because you came in at one level, but then you walked down these very steep stairs at the front of the building. Everybody down there could see who was coming in all the time.
Right.
So it was quite daunting going in there. You know,
if they could also see who you were leaving with.
They could,
find.
They could, But if you were in the public eye, you know, like you'd just broken a big story or you'd come back from a big job or you'd been on television doing something, it was always quite intimidating going in there,
Intimidating for you?
Yes.
Surely not.
No, I did,
The new supremo of the Daily Express.
Well, you know, I didn't like to boast about it, you know, it's just those things. Now then, have I told you about the super Lyme disease?
No, you haven't.
No, I keep
telling
you.
Because you're terrified of getting some kind of disease.
Well, let me tell you this.
I read a story today, right, that said that the incidence of tuberculosis in London
is
now higher than it is in some African countries.
I mean, that's outrageous.
But there's a very good reason for that, and I'm afraid that it's a reason a lot of people will not want to have explained to them, but it is in certain boroughs of London.
Yes.
There are certain communities in which tuberculosis is very prominent.
That's right, yeah.
Which does not mean that I'm going to get tuberculosis, or you're going to get tuberculosis, or any number of other people living in London is going to get tuberculosis.
But anyway, I keep saying to you, look, because I walk so extensively across the North Downs that sort of stuff, you know, I'm starting to get worried about getting Lyme disease.
Well, I've told you, as long as you don't go anywhere where there are deer, you'll be fine.
No, but it's spread way beyond that now.
Rubbish.
Listen to this.
Go on, then.
Alarm after Super-Lyme disease is now found in British ticks.
Really?
And these ticks are not just on deer anymore.
Where are they then?
New type of bacteria feared to be unresponsive.
Uh-huh.
Have you got that? Unresponsive to what?
To what?
To
treatment?
Antibiotics.
Yeah, well, so what? I mean, nobody's going to get these ticks suddenly attaching themselves to their skin unless they go in an area where the ticks live.
Scientists have discovered a new illness similar to Lyme disease spread by ticks and resistant to antibiotics, raising fears about growing numbers of people succumbing to debilitating symptoms. Like Lyme disease...
What are the symptoms of Lyme disease?
Well, I'm just about to tell you.
Well, let's test you and see if you've got any.
I'm just about to tell you, you fool.
Does one involve shouting a lot?
Like Lyme disease, the new disease causes headache, fatigue, muscle aches, recurrent fever.
Yeah. You got any of those?
And then what happens? Hey?
Have you got any of those?
No, not yet.
Well, that's fine then.
Yeah, but I might get them.
Well, you might get all sorts of things.
Yeah,
and then get run over by a bus.
And then it says you take a couple of antibiotics and then for about 48 hours your symptoms appear to go, but then they come back even worse.
Oh, yeah.
The new illness, which is yet to be named, is... What's your problem?
I don't know if you've got a name for it.
Well, I'm about
the scary new illness.
I'm about to tell you what it's called in Latin.
Okay, go on.
The new illness, which is yet to be named, is carried by bacteria called the Borrelia miyamatomi.
That doesn't sound Latin to me.
Borrelia miyamatomi.
Are you sure that's Latin?
I'm certain it's Latin.
I don't think it's Latin.
It is.
I'm not sure the Latins had a...
Miyamotoi. It's Borrelia miyamotoi.
Sounds Japanese.
No, it's not. It's not. It's Italian.
I don't think they had Y's in Latin, did they?
Of course they did, you idiot.
They had Y's?
Of course they did.
I don't think they did.
Yes, they did.
Well, give me a Latin word with a Y in it.
A Latin word with Y in it?
Yeah.
Let me think. That would be...
Porcus Maximus. You wouldn't have had it, would you?
Hang on a minute. That would be something like... E-Y-R. That's a verb.
E-Y-R?
Yeah.
Huh?
It's a verb.
Is that a spelling?
That's a verb.
What's a verb to mean what?
No, like some SS'd.
What?
E-Y-R. Yeah.
What?
It means I have, I had, I has.
I has?
Yes. Yeah, that's something.
I has a very bad grasp of Latin.
Or something like that. I have. Yeah. Anyway, listen, the point is, it says, this Borrelia miyamotoi are feared to be less responsive
sounds
to antibiotic
bad.
Treatment than other tick-borne bacteria. It can now be revealed for the first time that Borrelia miyamotoi has been found to be present in ticks in Britain by researchers at the Public Health Laboratory in Porton Down. So now we know. Now we know.
Now we know what?
Well, we know it's here.
We don't know it's here.
Porton Down's in Wiltshire, by the way.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. That's where they do a lot of germ warfare research, isn't it?
That's exactly what I'm saying.
Don't you think it's a bit unusual that they found anthrax at some farm in Wiltshire, which is not a million miles away from Porton Down?
Is that right?
Yeah. Well, that's a real story, not this nonsense about some super Lyme disease named
after a
Japanese scientist.
No, it's not Japanese. The problem is,
what is the problem?
That it can be mistaken for flu.
Yeah.
So you think you've got the flu. Now then, scientists and doctors...
Have you had your flu jab yet, by the way?
I'm doing it this week. Already have to cope with three types of bacteria associated with Lyme disease. They are Borrelia burgdorferi, Borrelia garinini... which causes neurological problems, and Borrelia afzelelli, which leads to skin lesions.
Mm. Well, certainly Lyme disease can lead to paralysis, which can be permanent if you don't, nip it in the bud early enough.
Yes.
I told you my mother got a bit of Lyme disease in America.
Well, you can't get a bit of it. You either get it or you don't get it.
She
if you
did.
Get it, you know, you're in very serious trouble.
No, she was fine because she was able to... I mean, she wasn't fine. She was quite ill for a while. But because of her age, and what the doctor said to her is that the Lyme disease will never actually leave you. However,
well, that's right.
However, it can remain dormant for the rest of your life, and she didn't suffer from any kind of permanent paralysis. But some people in America, when it became a big thing in the late 80s, would have a paralysis of the face.
And I know.
It would almost be like you'd have a stroke. Yeah, but it would almost be like palsy. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But I don't know why you worry about all these things.
Well, in case I get it, of course. Well, I don't want to be paralysed.
Well, you don't want. Nobody wants to be paralysed. I mean, nobody's putting their hand up for it.
The biggest problem is, and this comes from a woman called Mrs. Heish Shearers.
Mrs. Heish Shearers, I know her well.
Yeah, she's...
Who's she, then?
She's from Lyme Disease Action. Stella Heish Shearers.
Oh, yeah.
Of Lyme Disease Action.
Well, I suppose she would be banging the drum about Lyme disease from Lyme Disease Action.
She says, the difficulty about this bacterium is that it causes a relapse fever, so it can be misdiagnosed as flu or other viral infections, and early treatment with antibiotics will not be given. Mm. Patients who are not diagnosed and not treated appropriately run the risk of more serious consequences...
Right.
As can happen with Lyme disease.
I think you should stop worrying, honestly. I've got something for you more to worry about.
I might stop going out.
Yeah, good idea.
No, I might.
Well, how would you have to come in here in some kind of, you know, a suit?
No, germ, no, I don't mind getting in my car and driving here, but I'm going to stop walking across the countryside.
Well, what think just... of the effect that'll have on your health, though?
Well...
Maybe you just walk in a gym. Go to a gym and get on one of those, stair masters or something.
Maybe.
Now, we were talking about Halloween a little bit earlier on.
Yeah.
There was a story that was tweeted to me a little bit earlier in the day, where apparently there's a shortage of pumpkins this year. Now, I know you didn't care about the fact that there was a shortage of pine nuts.
And they're using something else, aren't they?
Well, they've suggested that people use turnips.
That's right, turnips, yeah.
Now, turnips, for me, are one of the few things that I really don't like eating.
But also, they're very hard to gouge out, turnips, compared to pumpkins.
I don't know. I mean, I've never tried to carve a pumpkin, have you?
They are. No, I haven't.
My kids do it every year.
Do they?
Because you can buy these kind of stencil effects that you can do.
Oh, I
see. They've done some very elaborate sort of cats.
Oh, good for them.
Witches and all that.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I don't think I could do it because I'm not very good at that sort of thing.
No,
doing that sort of thing with my hands.
I can imagine.
But, I mean, turnips are a completely different consistency, aren't they? I mean, they're solid in the middle.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
They're not soft in the middle.
They'd be very, very difficult. The best thing you do with a turnip is just hollow it out and stick a candle in it, because that to me is
well, even that sounds like quite hard work, doesn't it?
Well, not that hard.
I mean, it's like hollowing out a massive potato.
But I think it would be very hard work to try and turn a turnip into a face, if you see what I mean.
Well, apparently, according to the Grocer magazine, which I think is actually one of those magazines that I applied for a job with
I'm sure it is. It's one of those trade magazines that only half-bakes and deadbeats work for.
Yeah, well, I couldn't get a job there for that very reason. Now, apparently, the
harvest... Yeah, you didn't even qualify for those sort of
the harvest for the pumpkins are down as much as 50% because of the heavy rain in August. I wasn't here for half of August, so I can't say whether it's heavy rain or
not. Well,
you're not interested in this, are you?
Well,
I can tell.
The only thing...
I mean, you know, if it's your campaign and it's your kind of warning, you know, something about we're all going to die from some horrible disease, you know,
which I've just told
you
about,
If I'm telling you about something that everybody cares about, which is, whether or not
how many people
pumpkins.
Care? Halloween is an American...
It's not. It's Scottish, actually.
...tradition.
No, it's not. That
has been imposed upon us in this country.
I've said this to you many times before. Growing up in a Scottish house in London, we used to celebrate Halloween every single year.
All right, well,
and
as
I'd
as
go in, and I would go into to school, and nobody knew what I was talking about.
As far as I'm concerned, Halloween
we used to dress up.
Must, in that case, have drifted from Scotland to America and back to England.
Well, it must have done.
I'll tell you what, when I grew up as a kid, nobody celebrated Halloween.
No,
nobody.
They didn't. No, you're right, because it's not an English thing. However, it's become
trick
an English thing.
Trick or treat was not known.
No, but we didn't call it trick or treat. I think we called it first, you know, I think we called it guising or something like that up in Scotland.
Guising? I've never heard
But,
of
you
it.
Know, we had a treacle scone. We had ducking for apples. We dressed up as witches and wizards.
Yeah.
And we went knocking the doors of the people in our street.
You'd look like a right jerk, wouldn't you? As a witch.
I was a child.
As a wizard. Yeah.
I was a child.
Yeah, you were never a child. Do you know what you were? You were just a small sort of, like, bum. That's what
a
you
were. A small bum.
Yeah, yeah. Do you see what I mean?
Well, at least I wasn't mistreated by my parents. At least I wasn't abandoned by my parents.
You're a
psychologically tortured.
You were just like
for the rest of your life, you'd never be normal.
You were like a little nuisance blob, you were. I don't think you were ever a child, really.
Yeah.
I grew up in
Hampstead, you know.
Grew up in Hampstead?
Yeah.
Yeah, in a rented flat.
Yeah.
Only person in Hampstead who didn't live in a £1 million house. The peasants of Hampstead. Your family were like the Beverly Hillbillies of Hampstead.
Have you seen this?
You should have been called the Hampstead Hillbillies. That would have been good, wouldn't it?
Such a snob. Such a snob. You lived in a rented house. To Parry is an insult.
No, it's not.
It is, isn't it?
No, but hang on. Your rented house didn't even have central heating.
No.
didn't have any central heating. No. You live in a rented house.
But my parents loved me.
With no central
heating. They looked after
me.
They gave me a sense of self-worth.
Hang on,
all the things that you don't have.
Hang on, they loved you so much they made you live in, under the sink in the kitchen, didn't they? That's where you slept.
Yeah, I didn't mind that.
You didn't mind that. I mean, you know, what a jerk. I don't know. No wonder you got problems in life, pal.
If you love the Two Mics podcast, you'll love the live show. Weekday overnights from 1 a.m. on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 a.m. and via the TalkSport app. TalkSport, your Premier League station with exclusive commentaries every weekend.
What an absolute corker!
TalkSport.
My face, your Irish.
Look at the light!